This is a response to Once Forgiven, Now Free's video, Evolution is Stupid. This response was initiated by the YouTuber Frank's Voice, who recently paid a couple of kind visits to my channel in order to defecate textually in my comments section. Now, I'd vaguely heard of this user before and needless to say was intrigued, so I clicked my way over to his page and that's where I found a mirror of your video. I have to say that I was initially dumbstruck by the contents of your production because it may represent an all-new low point in creationist dishonesty, and considering the competition you're up against, that really did take some doing. Because of the sheer magnitude of your quite astonishing duplicity, I felt a moral obligation not to let it ride and instead to take the time to point out what a devious and insincere little Christian you are. Now, before we begin, I should mention that I am aware that you have an aversion to colorful language. So I want to warn you that because your video contains such mind-bogglingly outrageous deceit, it got me a little hot under the collar and I may not be able to control myself during this rebuttal. If you therefore don't like what you hear, might I suggest that you ask your friend Frank to keep his voice down in the future, or better still, just shut the fuck up completely. So with that, let's take a look at what you had to say in your video and why it pissed me off.
Was the cell designed? Well, let me help you out. Was this car designed? Now you might be thinking, wait a minute, that is not a fair analogy. One is living, the other is not. And you would be correct, it is not a fair analogy.
Well, that was innocuous enough. It was also nice to see that you're more than aware of the flaw in this analogy that creationists have been beating mercilessly for years, despite it having shuffled off this mortal coil a long, long time ago. Living systems can maintain homeostasis via a variety of physiological mechanisms and so can adapt to their environment and repair themselves. Additionally, they're capable of imperfect replication. Genetic variation caused by germline mutations, chromosomal crossing over during meiosis, and the recombination of parental alleles following gamete fusion leads to phenotypic variation in the resulting progeny. This variation acts as the feedstock for natural selection, which ensures that organisms displaying inherited traits that make them better suited to their environment are more likely to survive and reproduce and therefore pass on these traits to their offspring. Over periods measured in millions of years, this process leads inexorably to the continued divergence of species as they adapt to constantly changing ecological niches and ensures that they remain beautifully adapted to their respective environments. In contrast, a car which can't do anything other than sit where it's been parked is capable of doing nothing other than slowly turning into a pile of rust. The resulting intricacy and complexity produced by evolutionary processes generates the appearance of conscious design in organisms and yet is magnificently explained by the simple yet elegant conceptual framework known as evolutionary theory. This theory weaves together countless millions of pieces of independent physical evidence into a robust and coherent explanation of why and how organisms have diverged to produce the staggeringly vast array of life forms on planet Earth today. It also abolishes the need to invoke the existence of an invisible and undetectable designer that poofs each creature into being from thin air. Science has definitively demonstrated that if a designer does exist, it works from the bottom up, not the top down, and uses physical evolutionary processes to accomplish its end and not tawdry magic tricks. However, for those who are too stupid, too indolent, too apathetic, or too wedded to their primitive belief systems to learn anything about this process, it's presumably too difficult to conclude anything other than it all being the result of the cosmic equivalent of a cheesy Las Vegas variety act.
It is not a fair analogy because the living cell is much more complicated than the car. The car analogy does not do the cell justice.
Oh, for fuck's sake! Do you really expect anyone to take you seriously when you go and say something this misleading, this underhanded, and this devious? You've just attempted one of the slimiest tricks I've ever seen a creationist try to pull, one that's only worthy of a sneaky, mendacious little tosser of the first order. Of course, calling you that would be impolite in the extreme, so I'll restrict myself to saying that you should be as ashamed of yourself as your God would be if he existed. And if that seems a little harsh, then consider this. You ooze your way onto YouTube and present a tired and tatty argument against perhaps the most sublime accomplishment of the human intellect, and then admit that you're aware of why what you've shown is nothing more than a steaming pile of malodorous fecal matter. The decent thing to do in this situation is to either shut the fuck up immediately or to actually present a new and logical counter to the said refutation. Unfortunately, neither of these options was good enough for you, and instead you chose to merely skip over the problem and restate your fallacious argument while adding a few extra turds to it to make the pile seem all the more impressive. Unfortunately for you, your analogy still fails for the same reason, regardless of the actual magnitude of the difference in complexities of living cells and automobiles, and your pathetic and painfully transparent attempt at giving it the kiss of life has done nothing other than give you a terminal case of halitosis.
So the thing is, if you can't believe that unguided laws of nature can produce vehicles, how could you possibly believe that they can build living things which are way more complicated?
Because I, unlike you, understand and accept that there's a fundamental difference between living organisms and inanimate objects. You, of course, have demonstrated that you also understand this, but you're either intellectually crippled enough not to pursue the logic and the mountains of evidence to their rational conclusion, or intellectually bankrupt enough to ignore the gaping hole in your piss-poor excuse for an argument. Vehicles are not produced by unguided laws of nature because they cannot reproduce and are therefore not subject to Darwin's principle of descent with modification. Living organisms, on the other hand, can and are, and so can evolve complexity using mechanisms that are extremely well documented and understood by science. And while this process might indeed seem unguided in that it isn't reaching for some unseen goal, it's not the entirely random and directionless mechanism that you're presumably implying it is. Just because you're unable or unwilling to look into or acknowledge the way in which science can explain how these systems develop doesn't make your argument any more compelling. It just serves to demonstrate how ignorant or dishonest you are. If you want to be treated with a little more respect, then it'd serve you well to try and criticize the specifics of what evolutionary theory actually says instead of borrowing someone else's threadbare straw man and frenziedly whipping it until you've run out of both breath and common decency.
But it gets worse. If you are an atheist, then you are actually compelled to believe that cars are formed naturally by nature. Why? Because on your view, nature is all there is.
It's very nice of you to take the time to tell atheists what they must believe and save them the bother of thinking for themselves. It would have, however, been more helpful if you'd expended some thought on the matter before arrogantly opening your mouth and acting as if the material that came out of it was shinola and not what it actually sounded and smelled like. Firstly, atheists aren't compelled to believe anything about the origins of General Motors or any other motor vehicle manufacturer. They merely don't accept the existence of your or any other passing loon's god, and may or may not accept the existence of any god at all, depending on their level of agnosticism. They may do this after a great deal of thought and consideration, or because, perhaps like you, they refuse to think at all. But in either case, their views on the supernatural have nothing to do with their views on crankshafts and valve cover gaskets. Secondly, rationalists, if that's what you mean by atheists, accept only what's indicated by the evidence presented. This acceptance is always tentative and subject to modification or withdrawal pending the production of contradictory data. At present, everything happens to indicate that nature is all there is, since no evidence to support the existence of the supernatural in general and your special friend in particular has ever been forthcoming. In the absence of any evidence to explain a given physical phenomenon, such rationalists do the intellectually honest thing and use the label "I don't know" pending more information instead of filling the gaps in their knowledge with psychological comforting fluff and labeling it truth.
If you want to call yourself an atheist, then you have to believe that the four fundamental forces of nature can produce cars, computers, spaceships, and televisions. Now you might be thinking, but that's stupid.
You're right, I am. That was stupid. And dishonest in the extreme. Repeating the same misrepresentation doesn't make it any less repugnant or incorrect, no matter how many times you do it. Your little game should by now be obvious to anyone who takes the time to look at your video with anything even vaguely resembling an open mind. All you've done is construct a painfully transparent appeal to ridicule, presenting a patently ludicrous scenario that ignores the entire palace of knowledge erected by science that explains in great detail how this could have and probably did occur. In a certain sense, these laws did eventually produce vehicles, but it took them almost 14 billion years to do so, and then only after sentient beings that were capable of producing such designs had evolved. This is hardly the spontaneous assembly that you're implying is posited by evolutionary theory, and in reality the only people who claim that life can pop into existence out of nothing are creationists. If you really want to disprove evolutionary theory, then try doing the decent thing and debate against the actual evidence that supports it instead of constructing a deliberately misleading and inaccurate proposition and trying to pass it off as more than just the intellectual skid mark that it is.
And you would be absolutely right. And that is why I don't have enough faith to be an atheist.
So you can't be an atheist because you can't bring yourself to accept the preposterously laughable straw man you just presented. I don't blame you, because arguments of that quality are about as likely to have persuaded Mother Teresa to take up stripping as they are of convincing a rationalist that evolution is incorrect and that invisible, undetectable magic pixies are real. In reality, the veracity of evolutionary theory should have nothing to do with anyone's stance on the existence or non-existence of deities. All that science has done is provide essentially incontrovertible evidence of how life on this planet has diversified, but says nothing as to whether a god or collection of gods were involved in setting the ball in motion. As a result, there are still enough gaps in our knowledge at present to accommodate your special chum without you having to behave like a mentally incompetent or dishonest simpleton. But that's not what you really mean, is it? What you're really saying is that you can't or won't accept evolution because it's completely incompatible with the laughably childish myths in your holy book, and that you're either unable or unwilling to relinquish them, even though that means having to deny reality to the point of psychosis. I've come to this conclusion because on your channel page you claim to be a mechanical engineer and so should be more than intellectually capable of comprehending the evidence that you're distorting so flippantly. The fact that you're either unaware of or willing to lie about it speaks volumes about the magnitude of the cognitive dissonance reverberating around inside your head. As a final example of how low you're willing to sink to cling to your psychological safety blanket, let's take a look at how you finished off your video.
Then the intestines move back, and of course then the diaphragm can contract quite easily.
So this is a piston.
This is a piston.
Beautifully done. Couldn't be more beautifully designed. Evolved.
Has it occurred to you that the gentleman in this clip may have corrected himself because he was more than aware that the world's full of despicable, two-faced creationist scumbags who'd be more than willing to jump onto his words like anemic vampires onto a used tampon and use them against him? Alternatively, he could equally well have been being ironic in expressing how evolution is more than capable of producing creatures that to all intents and purposes superficially appear to be intentionally designed to fit their habitats. Without seeing this clip in the full context of the program from which it was culled, I can't distinguish between these two and yet other possibilities, but I can be certain of one thing, and that's that you didn't catch him in the act of revealing some kind of global scientific conspiracy aimed at perpetuating evolutionary theory at the expense of your pathetic little children's bedtime stories. Your eagerness to jump feet first into the slime to take this unbelievably lame and pathetic cheap shot only serves to showcase the dishonorable depths to which you're happy to plunge to protect your beliefs and the outrageous lies that you're more than willing to spread to defend them. If this kind of sordid and tawdry behavior is the best you can offer, if you're truly incapable of rational debate and honesty, if all you have is quote mining, misrepresentation, and character assassination, then that speaks volumes more about your position and your beliefs than I or anyone else ever could. This is a response to Once Forgiven, Now Free's video, The Living Dinosaur Gets Fossilized, itself a response to Holy Hallucinations 20. Unfortunately, Matt, rather than just sticking to addressing my criticisms, you decided to introduce a number of new points in your response. So in order to cover as much as I can, I'm going to have to take a slightly different tack in this video than I have in previous episodes, and I'm going to take a moment to clarify my position with respect to religion for the benefits of both yourself and my subscribers, and so I don't have to keep repeating myself later. You may have noticed that I'm an atheist. That is to say, I don't believe in any god or gods, and I do so because satisfactory empirical and verifiable evidence for their existence has never been presented to me. I'm also an agnostic because although at present I find the possibility unlikely, I can't honestly claim with certainty that a god or gods don't exist. I remain open to the presentation of new credible and objective evidence should it arise. I don't make videos against theism in general, partly because I think people are entitled to their beliefs as long as they don't force them onto others or try passing them off as fact, partly because I accept that I'm barely a layman in the areas of philosophy and theology, and partly because I realize that there are at present any number of ways to reconcile our understanding of the universe with theistic belief. I do, however, make anti-creationist videos because I am qualified to talk about science in general and biology in particular. I do so because while I'm tolerant of moderate theism, I find the behavior of fundamentalist scriptural literalists nothing short of repugnant. If they were to keep their ideas to themselves, that would be one thing, but when I see these beliefs being used to push political, social, and moral agendas onto others, I draw the line. In particular, I'll be fucked if I stand by and allow this laughably primitive bullshit to be fed to my children in science classes without doing my part to show it up for what it really is. So with all that said, there's a lot of ground to cover, so let's get started. As you said yourself, your first two points were off topic, but I decided to dedicate some of my limited time to addressing them lest I be accused of being unable to do so. So let's take a look at what they were, shall we?
So the first thing that shocked me was your bluntness to the fact that there are moral obligations. As a Christian, I believe in the fall, where humankind fell from our intimate relationship with God. See, evolution attempts to describe the way things are. It says nothing about the way things ought to be. If everything is just molecules clashing together, how do you get moral obligations?
Aside from the fact that you seem to shock rather easily, I have to say that I was a little puzzled as to why you latched onto this seemingly innocuous comment rather than addressing more of my other points, such as what I know now to be the blatant quote mine at the end of your video. If you're trying to draw me away from the original topic and my area of expertise, Matt, it isn't going to work. As I said earlier, I'm a poor layman when it comes to philosophy, so I'm not going to debate it. Rather than making a fool of myself in public, I prefer to leave this subject to such sterling YouTubers as Michael Payton 67 and Das American Atheist. But I do want to add that I am aware of the is-ought argument you mentioned and the fact that Theoretical Bullshit, undoubtedly my favorite YouTuber of all time, included it in his three recent incredible videos on morality. If you want to discuss it further, I suggest you try it with him. Just don't forget to strap a crash helmet to your ass before you do. Now, having said that, I'd still like to point out that were I to accept the argument from morality or any other philosophical construct for the existence of God, it would do nothing to prove the veracity of your religious views any more than it would anyone else's. How would the existence of objective moral values prove that your Bible was inerrant and that evolution was false? The answer is that it wouldn't, and the subject is completely irrelevant to the topics we're discussing. I'd also like to point out that just because I used the phrase moral obligation doesn't mean I should be expected to elaborate by explaining my entire belief system any more than my claiming that Nephilim Free is a wanker would require me to follow up by providing a concise summary of the joys and history of the five-knuckle shuffle. But since you asked, my use of the phrase was intended to be ironic. I find it personally distasteful in the extreme when I hear creationists whose religion supposedly imbues them with some kind of moral superiority telling the most outrageous lies about science, scientists, atheists, and pretty much anything else that counters their personal beliefs. If you want examples of the kind of Olympian-level dishonesty I'm referring to, then simply spend an hour or two watching some of my other videos. Just remember to keep a bucket handy.
So atheists will often mock Christians, saying that they don't understand evolution, and if they only understood it, then they would accept it. But here, you demonstrate that you don't understand the Bible. If you think the Bible is a pathetic little children's bedtime story, then that is one of the worst literary classifications I've ever heard of.
What you haven't appreciated, Matt, is that if I ever addressed moderate Christians, I wouldn't use the storybook line because they're not delusional enough to truly believe that the Bible is an accurate historical and scientific document. I use it with people like yourself who actually believe that the patently and verifiably obvious fables such as the Genesis account and the Noachian flood, amongst many others, are genuine reports of past events. It's in this respect that I call it a storybook, because in this respect it is a storybook, though quite frankly Harry Potter's more realistic, The Lord of the Rings is better written, and both are far more entertaining. And as for your claim for it being historically accurate, I'm also not going to be pulled into a theological discussion on the historicity of the Bible, because again, it's not my field, and that's the kind of stuff that's best left to the marvelously entertaining and erudite Prof. MTH and his fellow ex-Christian It's the Superfly. If you should decide to ask them their opinions, then might I also suggest that you apply some superglue to that crash helmet to be sure it doesn't fall off.
What exactly indicates that nature is all there is? Are there some experiments that have indicated that the natural world is all there is? You claim that everything indicates that nature is all there is. Now, that's a very bold claim. So please provide one, only one, piece of evidence that indicates that nature is all there is. That should be easy since, as you said, everything indicates that nature is all there is.
This really blew my mind, Matt. It really did. Now, to be fair, you preceded this by playing a clip from my video where I clearly say, at present, everything happens to indicate that nature is all there is, since no evidence to support the existence of the supernatural in general and your special friend in particular has ever been forthcoming. And yet, despite that, you still managed to somehow completely ignore the second half of my sentence. These words that you neglected to take into account when you formulated your question, Matt, were placed there for a special purpose. They weren't puked up accidentally one morning by my word processor when I wasn't looking after it had spent a debauched night on my hard drive with a bottle of Jack Daniels and a sleazy spreadsheet it had picked up in virtual memory. Your question, therefore, Matt, is meaningless. My position is that every piece of repeatable, verifiable, empirical evidence generated in the history of science has indicated that the universe consists of a physical reality governed by natural laws. As I clearly stated, and you ignored, no such corresponding evidence has been generated to support the existence of the supernatural. If you want people to accept your beliefs, then the onus is on you to provide positive evidence to support them and not on me to prove a negative. And if you're thinking about turning around and saying that I'm being dishonest because I'm not accepting the possibility of the supernatural in the light that there's been no evidence to disprove it, then think again. Because I didn't use the word indicate for either decorative or aesthetic purposes, but to specify that the statement wasn't meant as a pronouncement of epistemic certainty, but of our current understanding based on the evidence before us. When or if the evidence changes, then so will my mind.
Do you not agree that the natural world is finite and that it had a beginning? Is that not pretty good evidence that there is something beyond the natural world? Since, you know, the natural world didn't always exist?
Once again, Matt, you're trying to drag the debate into the area of philosophy and I'm not going to bite. What I will say, though, is that at present it's unclear as to whether the natural world had a true beginning, whether the universe has always existed, or even whether it's just an infinitesimally small speck in an infinitely large multiverse. In other words, the jury's very much still out on this question and the intellectually honest answer is, I don't know. In addition, even if I conceded the point, and this would certainly not be pretty good evidence that there was something beyond the natural world, at best it would be an argument that this might be the case. I continue to find it astounding how creationists have such low standards for what they will consider as evidence in favor of their arguments and yet happily dismiss mountains of empirical data that speak against them. Double standards, anybody?
You don't like my analogy because living things reproduce and change. And actually, you went on a long rant about how living things change over time. First of all, no one disagrees with this. I can go to creation.com and learn all about how living things change, about how mutations work.
Matt. I'm not sure what made my jaw drop when I heard this. The fact that this is how you do your research or that you didn't realize how bad admitting it would make you look. You're arguing against the science that proves that your worldview is wrong, Matt, so don't you think that it's incumbent on you to research what the science actually says? To read the actual papers? Examine the actual data? Apparently not, because you admitted that you get all your information from biased sources that have been shown to dishonestly misrepresent the science time and time again. Don't you think that it might have been more appropriate to learn how mutations work from a book on, say, genetics? Presumably, by this logic, if you needed to learn something about embryology, you'd find it reasonable to lock yourself in a bathroom for an hour with a copy of Playboy. You would be better served, Matt, by looking at the actual research you're disparaging and formulating some criticisms of your own instead of relying on some fucktard's concoction of quote minds and straw men. And if you don't, then you shouldn't be surprised if the smell rubs off on you. I'm finding it really hard not to get personal with you at this point, Matt, because this was just, well, pathetic. Really, really pathetic.
Creationists just believe that the variation is limited to the genetic variability built into the genome. That's why you can take a wolf and you can breed it into a dog, or say a poodle. However, you can't take a poodle and breed it back into a wolf. Why not? Because the information has been lost. It's no longer there. The genetic variability has been removed, and that information has been lost. It's a one-way street, downhill.
And this is what you get when you dredge up your information from the shit pits that you insist on frequenting, Matt. I'm going to ignore the fact that you didn't take the time to define what you meant by information and infer from what you said that you meant the number and frequency of alleles in the parental lupine population. Firstly, what do you mean by downhill? What criteria do you use to claim that a poodle is somehow worse than a wolf, Matt? I guarantee that you won't find one that doesn't require logical contortions that would qualify you as an act in Cirque du Soleil, because at the end of the day, a poodle is just different from a wolf in the same way that most humans are just different from chimpanzees. Secondly, domestic dogs are still wolves in the same way as humans are still apes, apes are still primates, primates are still eutherians, and eutherians are still mammals. In this respect, the majority of the original lupine alleles are still present in the clade. Just because poodles don't share the same alleles with wolves doesn't mean that those alleles have been lost. They're still present in wolves and distributed over the different breeds of dog alive today. Creationists keep making this mistake because no matter how many times they're told that it's populations, not individuals, that evolve, they continually seem to be unwilling or unable to understand it. This is exactly why shitwits like Kirk Cameron and his cuddle buddy Ray Comfort seem to think that it's reasonable to expect a new species of animal to pop out of its mother's private parts fully formed. Thirdly, in the broader context, these arguments always ignore the process of gene duplication that can be caused by errors in homologous recombination, retrotransposons, and chromosome duplication. These processes allow the mutation of one of the duplicated genes without loss of function and therefore the evolution of new sequences and new information. And if you think that the article on Creation Ministries International that claims to debunk this will help you, you might want to think again, Matt. I found three major lies in the first page alone, and the fact that it was written by a fucking psychologist should ring an alarm bell or two. Finally, even without the process of gene duplication, it's been demonstrated that in an in silico simulation of evolution, new information can and does evolve using just the principles of mutation and natural selection alone. In summary, Matt, this is the kind of argument that arises when you take for granted and blindly repeat someone else's opinion without researching it for yourself. If you don't do that and it turns out that your source was either mentally constipated, high on Jesus juice, or simply lying like a priest in a choir boy's changing room, then it'll do nothing but reflect badly on you.
But my video was addressing more the origin of life, or at least the origin of molecular machinery, which is similar to car engines.
Okay, this is where I came closest to deciding to break my promise about not insulting you. So Matt, if you were addressing more the origins of life, then why the fuck did you call your video Evolution is Stupid? And as for the origin of molecular machines, I refer you back to my previous video, The Same Principles All Apply. I have to say that I've noticed and commented on this tactic before, and I find it particularly reprehensible. Creationists seem to have a penchant for conflating abiogenesis with evolution, presumably in the hope that our imperfect understanding of the former will rub off on our very deep understanding of the latter. This is perhaps the most dishonest thing you've done so far, Matt, and although I'm going to give you the benefit of the doubt and assume that you didn't do it deliberately, you really should be embarrassed at yourself.
It's a serious problem for your worldview, and when you don't admit it, but instead you just turn to ridicule and mockery and swearing, it says a lot more about you than you think it does. You can ridicule me all you want, but it won't change my mind. If you want to change my mind, you'll need to give me evidence.
It's not a serious problem, Matt, because I fill the gaps in my knowledge with I don't know and not God did it. Of course, you're perfectly free to do the latter as long as you don't claim that my lack of knowledge is proof of your assertion. As I said in my video, there are still plenty of gaps for theists to put their God, and the origin of life is one of them. If you ever decide to take that step though, Matt, I'd recommend that you perhaps choose one of the ones surrounding the Big Bang, because my suspicion is that the others will slowly start filling up sometime in the not too distant future. And as for my language, I turn to ridicule and swearing because I'm quite frankly sick and tired of the lies and dishonesty of creationists who continue putting up the same tired old arguments no matter how many times their mistakes have been pointed out to them. Quite frankly, my patience has fucking run out. And finally, my intention is certainly not to change your mind or that of anyone else that I address in my videos. You folks are way far too gone for mere reason to get through to you, and any change has to come from within yourselves. Instead, I settle for taking the piss out of your ludicrous ideas and pointing out your misrepresentations in the hope that this may prevent at least one or two innocents from being polluted by them.
Let's assume that computers do gain consciousness and become a sort of life form that can reproduce and write its own software. Would that convince you that computers can form naturally simply because they can reproduce and write their own software? I think you'll quickly realize that if a computer could do these things, this would be evidence of an amazing engineering feat. I say the same thing about living things. It's only logical. Please show me where I'm wrong in my thinking.
Your analogy fails on multiple levels, Matt, including logically. Just because theoretical man-made self-replicating computers were initially consciously designed says nothing about where the cells were. It's still an argument from ignorance. It also fails in the case of your computers because we would have evidence that they were designed by a consciousness because we would know who the original designers were. In the case of cells, we have no such evidence and therefore no a priori reason to make the assertion. If for some reason we'd lost this knowledge, the only thing we'd be justified in saying about the origin of computers pending the discovery of pertinent evidence would be we don't know. Anything else would be pure speculation. In fact, your analogy not only fails, but also serves you extremely poorly because it highlights exactly how intellectually weak your position is. Let me explain. Let's say one day that all life on this fictional Earth goes extinct and all that's left are the computers. Two spaceships arrive. One full of creationist aliens, and one full of empirical rationalists. By your own logic, the creationists should immediately come to the conclusion that these computers were created by their divine being, since something must have designed their complexity. The rationalists, on the other hand, might initially reserve judgment. Instead of taking the easy way out by explaining everything with their god and then smugly congratulating themselves for their deductive skills, they might begin studying the computers instead. Upon further investigation, they might realize that many of the computer components could be constructed using known physical processes. They may even be able to duplicate some of these processes themselves, perhaps even start building their own simpler versions. Any of this sounding familiar, Matt? In this scenario, and with our a posteriori knowledge, we see that the rationalists have a chance of discovering that these computers have a natural explanation, while the creationists, satisfied with putting it all down to the supernatural and settling for spending the rest of their time basking in their certain truth and indulging in their mutual mental masturbation, explain everything by being 100% wrong. So how do you know that this isn't exactly what you and your fellow creationists are doing right now, Matt? I mean, really know. If you looked at it honestly for just a moment, if you opened up yourself to the possibility that you might be wrong, you might just be able to look at the evidence with an open mind and realize that you don't have a leg to stand on. So for the last time, Matt, the science that you're actively denying like a child who doesn't want to give up their favorite toy does not and cannot deny the existence of gods. It just places limits on the claims humans can make about how they created the universe and life on Earth. The world is full of theists in general and Christians specifically who found a way to integrate their God into reality, so it is possible, and some of them are even subscribed to me and support my goals here on YouTube. And if you can't do that, Matt, if you can't pull your mind out of the Dark Ages, if you can't reconcile your beliefs with reality, if you continue denying the undeniable with no regard to the evidence, then you're doomed to remain a laughingstock to everyone other than the rapidly shrinking group of anachronistic misfits that think the same way you do until one day you'll find yourself all alone. This is a response to Nephilim Free's video, Overlapping and Embedded Genes. Hello again, Neph. It's been a while since I addressed any of your malodorous videos because I felt it only fair to let you recover from the double fisting I gave you in Holy Hallucinations 9 and 10. But now that you're hopefully feeling a little less dilated, I thought it was high time that I paid you a friendly visit and put you straight on one or two little inaccuracies I found in your video regarding the nature of overlapping genes. Now, anyone who's had the misfortune and intestinal fortitude to watch one of your originals from start to finish will already know of your prodigious talent for taking 10 minutes to haphazardly stumble through what can be said in two. As a result, there may be some repetition in the clips I'm going to show from your video, but that seemed to be the only way in which I could present the occasional new fecal nugget that you intermittently introduced during your seemingly endless regurgitation of the same point. But before I play the first one, you should note that if you happen to think that you're sounding a little more eloquent than usual, it's because I took the time to edit out the ubiquitous pregnant pauses that intersperse your craptodidactic prose like peanuts in a squirrel turd. It's hard to watch your videos without repeatedly banging your head against the keyboard until your ears bleed neff, and so I decided to do my best to shield my subscribers from sharing the pain. Take my advice. If you're doing it because you're laboring under the impression that it makes you sound thoughtful or intelligent, then you're wrong, because the effect's eerily reminiscent of an intellectually impaired lobotomized chimpanzee with a concussion. And if you're not doing it deliberately, then might I suggest a script, an audio processor, and just a small modicum of pride in your work. Radical thoughts, I know, Neff, but they really will help alleviate the impression that your moonlighting is a stand-in for Forrest Gump. So now that I've finished impugning your intelligence, let's get on to the part where I factually demonstrate that these weren't ad hominem attacks, but rather a reasonably accurate description of observable reality. You may want to go and find something to bite down on while I play the first clip, Neff, because this is going to sting a little.
I explained to her that one of the problems with the idea that random genetic mutation has developed in the genome of all the life forms of the Earth, and is the stuff of life for evolution, is the fact that we have discovered that genes are often overlapping and embedded.
Okay, Neff, now that we have the basis for your thesis, I'll take a little time to describe the general structure of eukaryotic genes. This'll make it somewhat easier for anyone watching this video to follow what I'm saying when I get to pointing out exactly and precisely why you're full of crap. In general, bacterial genes are stretches of DNA containing an uninterrupted linear sequence of coding information for their respective proteins. By contrast, most mammalian genes aren't contiguous and their coding regions are broken up by islands of non-coding sequence known as introns. After transcription into RNA, the exons containing the coding information need to be joined by removal of introns in a process named splicing that occurs in structures named spliceosomes and can be envisaged as being akin to excising adverts from a movie before watching it. This mature messenger RNA of fused exons can then be translated into the final protein by ribosomes. Since the genetic code is read in triplet form, where a codon of three consecutive bases represents one amino acid in the encoded protein, each mRNA can be read in three potential reading frames depending on where translation is actually initiated. The actual region of translation is delineated by stop and start codons. Since these are seldom located at the ends of the transcript, not all of the original exonic material codes for protein, and the non-coding ends are named the 5' and 3' untranslated regions. So now that I've laid the groundwork, let's get on and take a look at what kind of monumental lies a creationist can conjure out of thin air by just reading an abstract or two, praying to his ephemeral special friend for inspiration, and willfully ignoring anything that even vaguely resembles a fact. But before we do that, Neff, I was curious by what you meant by the phrase, "we have discovered," when referring to overlapping genes. In fact, you seem to be very fond of using this particular conjunction in this video, and if you don't believe me, then take a look at this.
We will continue to discover. We have discovered. So far we have discovered. We may discover. We continue to discover. We have discovered. We continue to discover.
Of course, the reality, Neff, is that you couldn't discover your own arse in the dark with both hands, let alone anything in the field of molecular genetics. I found this particularly galling because the people who actually did the discovering that you're referring to are the same people who'd piss their pants with laughter if they ever heard you ignorantly opining on the subject that they've spent decades working in. I've said it before and I'll say it again, your 2 years of typing evolution is a lie into Google and voraciously lapping up anything it spat back at you like a pig at a trough full of swill doesn't make you an expert in anything other than dishonesty and gullibility. The quality of your online education's evident every time you open your mouth, and no more so than in the next clip.
This illustration demonstrates why all genetic mutations cause degradatory effects to the genome's code. Because if a random genetic mutation which affects this portion of the gene takes place, it will affect this gene. So even if we were to find that a genetic mutation provided some imagined benefit to this gene, which is exceedingly rare, it is almost certain that it would cause degradatory effects to this one. Because genes are overlapping and embedded, random genetic mutations typically affect more than one gene at a time.
I was puzzled when I first saw this, Neff, because the figure you're referring to isn't annotated in English. It turns out there's a good reason for that, and that's because you found it on a Finnish creationist website. It seems that you're broadening your horizons, Neff, which is nice, since all other indications are that you really don't get out much. Now, this diagram of yours bears no semblance to any genetic locus I've been able to find, and since your Eurotrash website, of course, didn't give any indication of a primary source for the figure, I think it's safe to assume that it's been concocted for the sole purpose of allowing shamelessly dishonest reptiles like you to misrepresent the complexity of overlapping genes. Your little artistic interpretation, though, does illustrate the basic concept, and that is of a genetic locus containing two or more genes that share at least some of the same physical sequence. An overlapping gene can reside on the same strand of DNA as its partner and be in the same or different reading frame, or more commonly on the opposite antisense strand. Because of the anti-parallel structure of the DNA helix, same strand overlaps always run in the same direction, while antisense overlaps run head-to-head or tail-to-tail. Additionally, one gene can be embedded entirely within another, and when it resides within only one of its partner's introns, it's referred to as nested. Now, despite your mendacious assertions, Neff, there are many reasons why the restrictions on the mutation of overlapping genes aren't quite as stringent as you would have the poor people you're trying to deceive with your vile lies believe. And now I'm going to proceed to ram those reasons up your jacksie one by one. 1. Just because genes overlap doesn't mean that they share exons. The coding sequences of nested or embedded genes are entirely contained within one or multiple introns of their hosts, and Makalovska and colleagues showed that these represent over 50% of overlapping human genes. Since mutations in the embedded gene only affect the introns of its host, they have no effect on its coding sequence and so aren't subject to the restrictions you're talking about. 2. The genetic code is redundant. The 3-nucleotide 4-base system produces 64 possible codons so that all of the 20 amino acids are represented by more than one. As a result, any given point mutation may be synonymous and result in no change in the protein sequence in one gene of an overlapping pair, but may concurrently be a missense mutation that alters the peptide sequence of the other. 3. Not all missense mutations result in an alteration in protein structure or activity. Such conservative mutations substitute one amino acid with a structurally similar one which, depending on its structural context in the protein, may not produce any functional change. This kind of mutation in one gene may not be so innocuous in its overlapping sibling, allowing the two genes to diverge. 4. 75% of antisense genes don't code for protein products and may function to regulate the transcription of their cognate partners. In this instance, mutation in either gene would, by definition, not be restricted by the other. 5. Gene duplication facilitates the generation of new copies of the overlapping genes and the subsequent unrestricted generation of mutant alleles in the presence of a functional second copy. I'm not surprised that you neglected to mention this little tidbit, Neff, because by now creationists are well versed in deliberately ignoring this well-documented and understood process whenever they spuriously claim that mutations cannot generate new information. And 6, in the absence of any of these mechanisms, you'd still be wrong because there's a problem with your argument that's so big that even someone as astonishingly simple-minded as Shock of God would be able to see it. But I'm not going to spill the beans quite yet, Neff, so let's just let that thought sink in and let the tension build a little. Meanwhile, I think I'll finish up on this point, Neff, since you might be feeling rather full. So while you're recovering from the rectal overload, let's watch you frenziedly flogging your dead horse again as if your friend's disability check depended on it.
But the point is that random genetic mutations are degradatory to the code of the DNA molecule, and overlapping and embedded genes is one of the reasons they are so degradatory, because a random genetic mutation which occurs to one gene very well may affect another, or another and another. Or another, and another, and another.
Okay, Neff, I'm not going to bother responding to your deliberately erroneous assertion that random mutations are degradatory to the genetic code, because that's already been roughly stuffed back up your ass more times than your router's been connected to the erosguide.com server. Instead, I want to focus on the number of times you used the word another. I counted 6, so with the first gene you mentioned, that makes 7 sharing at least one codon. I've yet to read a single report of even a triple gene overlap, so I think it's fair to say that you are being a little less than accurate, presumably in a transparent attempt to again exaggerate the limitations of gene overlap on the generation of diversity. The only thing I'm having a hard time with is distinguishing whether you said this because you are still basking in the afterglow of a particularly vicious cerebral infarction, Or because you're just a dishonest little piss-stain who's willing to say or do anything to maintain his delusion that he actually has some sort of argument to make?
Sophia, you're behind. Genes are indeed overlapping and embedded. As time goes on, we will continue to discover more and more and more of these overlapping and embedded genes. So far, we've discovered hundreds. Before we're through, we may discover many thousands.
As usual, Neff, your assertion is nothing more than a pathetic and easily exposed lie, though I can't be sure whether you said it deliberately or inadvertently because your head's permanently wedged up inside your colorectal cavity. So let's examine your claim that we're only just scratching the surface of the embedded gene count by taking a little drive down memory lane. Prior to the invention of DNA sequencing, it was thought that one gene coded for just one protein. But following the sequencing of the first DNA genome, bacteriophage 5X174, by Fred Sanger's group, a feat which played a central role in him winning his second Nobel Prize, it became clear that there were exceptions to this rule. Subsequently, overlapping genes were discovered in many viruses and are elegantly explained as an evolutionary strategy to minimize genome size due to the size restrictions imposed by capsid geometry. Later, overlaps are also found to be relatively common in bacteria, which are also under some evolutionary pressure to restrict genome size. As an aside, isn't it interesting, Neff, that these observations are perfectly understandable in the light of evolutionary theory, whereas your alternative, God did it so he could be dark and mysterious, leaves you as ignorant as a sad bastard with a pretend degree. Now, getting back on track, it was therefore surprising that during the late 80s and 90s, handfuls of overlaps started turning up in eukaryotes, which are thought to be relatively unaffected by such selective pressures. Then, following the sequencing of the human and other genomes, it became possible to search for overlaps using algorithms that predict the presence of open reading frames. That's where those hundreds you mentioned came from back in 2004, and there's been no significant change in the numbers since because there are no more genes to be found. Your projection, therefore, of there being thousands more to come is about as ambitious as Bill Dembski's and William Myers' hopes for a Nobel Prize, because after all, it's now 2001 and we're still waiting. So with that behind us, we now get to the point I've been looking forward to for the whole of this video, Neff. So tie down your headphones, grit your teeth, and hold on tight, because this one's going to make your eyes water.
According to this paper, thus far are discovered 774 genes overlapping in the human genome and 542 genes overlapping exons in the human genome, compared to 578 genes which are overlapping in the mouse genome and 455 genes with overlapping exons in the mouse genome. Notice the difference in the number of overlapping genes. The discovery of overlapping genes is just in its infancy. As time goes on, we continue to discover more and more genes which are overlapping, or embedded, or both.
Of course, this last statement only serves to demonstrate that the only thing that's in its infancy is your intellectual development, Neff, because I just explained why your claim about the future trends of overlapping gene discovery is about as accurate as a Kent Hovind tax return. The mistake you made here was using an actual paper instead of just showing us your usual series of screenshots of abstracts, layman science pages, and creationist websites. So the first thing I did was track down the actual document and do what you obviously never did, and that's read it. And having done that, I'm now in the happy position of being able to use it to beat seven shades of shit out of you. You see, Neff, while your numbers might sound impressive to someone who didn't know any better, they did leave out a minor point. And that's that these genes were found in genomic databases containing 34,604 human and 33,936 murine genes. Now, I'm assuming that long division isn't your strong point, Neff, so I'll do the math for you. That means that of all the genes examined, only 2.2% were overlapping in humans and 1.7% in mice. Hardly the impressive figures you are making them out to be, eh? But wait, it gets better. Genes that don't contain exonic overlaps don't count because mutations and overlapping introns have no effect on protein sequence and therefore aren't subject to the mutational restrictions you're claiming are a death knell to evolutionary theory. So when you only count the genes that contain exon overlaps, you come down to values of 1.6% in humans and 1.3% in mice. Not looking any better for you, is it, Neff? And if you think that's bad, then all you have to do is read the rest of the table you showed us and think back to something I said about exons earlier in this video. Remember that I said that parts of the exon sequences in the mature mRNA weren't actually translated into protein and therefore weren't coding. Well, it turns out, Neff, that the vast majority of even these exon overlaps are in non-coding regions. In the end of the day, only 57 human genes overlapped in coding regions and 31 in mice. That works out to be less than 0.1 to 0.2% of all the genes in the human or murine genome, Neff, or as we trained scientists like to put it, absolutely fuck all. I'd love to know how you managed to miss this, Neff, I really would. Was it because those difficult long words in the paper were just a little too much for you? Or because you chose to ignore it because the truth was just a little too inconvenient? Well, now that I think I've unequivocally stuffed your ideas back where they belong, I should start wrapping up, as this has already turned out to be a lot longer than I'd hoped. And while there are a number of other annoying putrid flecks of misinformation sprinkled throughout your video, there was one that I felt I just couldn't let slide. So let's take a look at it, and then I'll let you get off to the pharmacy for a little relief.
Geneticists today are shying away from the use of the word gene because it really doesn't properly describe what we observe in the genome of life. The preferred term is sequences.
Do you really believe the mind-bending inanity of the verbal spew you bring up every time you open your mouth, Neff? That's a rhetorical question, of course, because I think it's quite clear from your videos that you've a misplaced ego larger than Joel Osteen's bank account. Of course, this is complete and utter bollocks, because the word sequence means what it's always meant to trained and qualified biological scientists. That is, the conceptual representation of the linear order of bases in any given segment of nucleic acid. While the word gene refers to a unit of heredity that is physically manifested as a specific region of DNA with a specific sequence. Despite your demented rambling, Neff, nothing's changed. Just because an ignorant and intellectually compromised bozo asserts the contrary with the expectation that his hallucination will be unquestioningly accepted doesn't change the definition of these words. It only demonstrates his profound arrogance and the magnitude of the gulf that separates his perception from that thing that the rest of us refer to as reality. This is a response to Shock of God's video, The Great Evolution Debate. I have to admit that deciding to make this video left me facing what appeared to be an impossibly complex conundrum. You see, the only thing I find shocking about you and the material you present on your channel and website is the mind-bending combination of stupendous ignorance and stupidity that you try and peddle as fact. As a result, I found it almost impossible to decide whether to call you Cock of God or Shock of Shite, since both seemed equally amusing and appropriate. And then I had an epiphany. Unfortunately for you, it didn't involve angels or a bearded old transcendental gentleman, but instead a solution to unraveling my troublesome little Gordian knot. So for the purposes of this video, I shall both have my cake and eat it, and will be referring to you as Cockshite. So now that I've dealt with the formalities, let's roll up our sleeves and get stuck in, shall we?
And when you get there, click right here on the right where it says Music and Podcast. I want to get your opinion on this. I want to get your opinion on these errors of evolution.
So you want my opinion, do you, Cockshite? Well, since you asked so nicely, it'd just be plain rude for me not to acquiesce to your request now, wouldn't it? But as I do just that, you might want to consider being a little more careful about what you ask for in the future. Not unless, that is, you're particularly partial to a good old-fashioned reaming every now and again. So with that in mind, I did as you asked and followed the link that you kindly pointed out, and what do you think I found there? A 35-minute diatribe of outrageous dishonesty from that repulsive fleck of tuberculotic sputum otherwise known as William Lane Craig. According to his Reasonable Faith website, this is a podcast from a regular Sunday school indoctrination session he holds and calls Defenders. Now, Mr. Craig generally confines his dishonesty to the area of philosophy where he's in somewhat less danger of being called out on his bullshit by minor inconveniences such as the facts and reality. Since I don't make pretensions in this area, I've pretty much given him a wide berth in the past and merely stood by the sidelines laughing as his arguments were rammed unceremoniously back into place by those much more capable than I. In this instance, however, Billy Boy decided to educate his flock on his version of the subject of evolution, and that's something that I'm more than willing to correct him on. However, the fetid toilet that passes for Billy's brain was so stopped up in this lecture that it would take me literally hours to mop up all of the pseudo-cerebral sewage that it disgorged over the course of this fine example of mental masturbation, willful ignorance, and deliberate dishonesty. So because you're the subject of this episode, cockshite, I'm going to stick to addressing the points you made in your poorly argued and appallingly disingenuous video. However, since you based all your dubious assertions on this Soul Craig podcast, I think it's only fair to spend some time in addressing the quality of your one and only source. Let's take a look at how Billy Boy kicked off his disgusting spewathon.
Today we have our third lesson on tape, during which we're going to describe the scientific evidence pertinent to the origin and evolution of biological complexity.
I found the irony in this introduction really quite stunning, because it appears to be from the very same William Lane Craig who arrogantly dismisses the ideas of those without formal training in his own field as being unworthy of consideration. It's difficult to find words to describe the kind of two-faced shitwad that can hold this kind of opinion and then expect himself to be afforded any kind of respect when expounding on subjects in which he himself has no qualifications. Now, I don't want this to be taken as an ad hominem attack because even two-faced shitwads can be right. The sole purpose of the previous statement was to demonstrate Billy Boy's shitwad status, mainly because I had the opportunity to do so, but also because he deserves to be exposed for what he truly is. So with that said, let's go on and see why this particular wad also happens to be full of shit.
So that the Christian is open to following the evidence wherever it might lead. The Christian, unlike the atheist, is not committed to just one view of biological origins, but rather can afford to follow the evidence where it leads.
This sentence itself demonstrates the brazen and unashamed dishonesty of this smug and arrogant little pustule of a man, and why he's a disgrace to the academic tradition to which he disingenuously pretends to hold. By this, Craig means that the atheist is unable to consider theistic explanations for origins, while the open-minded Christian is able to follow the evidence freely. The utter banality of this statement itself demonstrates the intellectual bankruptcy of this pathetic excuse for a thinking man because it fails on pretty much every level conceivable. Firstly, in the context of his diatribe, Bilbo is falsely conflating everyone who accepts naturalistic explanations of origins under the title atheist. Of course, a large number of working scientists that accept evolutionary theory, including some very prominent names, are theists, and Craig, I'm sure, is more than aware of this. Somehow, these theists, most of them Christians, have managed to accept the modern synthesis of Darwinian evolutionary theory, and so it is hardly the sole domain of atheists. Could Bill really be stooping so reprehensibly low as to conflate evolution with the bogeyman of atheism just to sway his young and impressionable audience? What a spectacular turd. Secondly, why is it that Billy Bob doesn't seem to think that the Christian is in any way constrained in exploring the evidence in directions that might suggest the absence of a creator? Doesn't this reasoning seem a little one-sided to you? It certainly seems a little less than rigorous coming from someone who claims that he's a professional philosopher and not just a dishonest spiv with an agenda. Finally, Craig completely misses the point of the scientific enterprise, and that's to discover the truth regardless of what that might be. In reality, the only view that any scientist is committed to is finding the best explanation for the physical evidence possible, regardless of the philosophical or theological implications of that explanation. To date, we've been unable to empirically determine the existence of any kind of non-naturalistic phenomena in any field of study, including evolutionary biology, and therefore are compelled to exclude them from our current models of reality. If Mr. Craig were to stop producing brain farts for a moment and instead produce some solid evidence of magic, then scientists would be happy to incorporate his observations into their models of reality where appropriate. Instead, he contents himself with playing word games for a living with the apparent conviction that he can discover something concrete about the nature of reality just by talking about it instead of actually testing it. Now, while this isn't one of the points you raised in your video, cockshite, I brought it up here because the entirety of this podcast is peppered with a seemingly endless array of similar examples of sloppy thinking, misinterpretation, and appeals to personal disbelief, misplaced authority, and quite astonishing ignorance. I decided to use this particular example in order to demonstrate the quality of the material on which you've based your sad excuse for an argument. But before I get back to that, I just wanted to point out one more thing, and that's the nature of the material that Billy Boy himself is relying on to pontificate about fields of study that he obviously has not one whit of a clue about. Let's take a look at the four books he cites to back up his repulsive lies.
The Mystery of Life's Origin by Faxton, Bradley, and Olson. Philip Johnson's book, Darwin on Trial. Michael Denton's book, Evolution, A Theory in Crisis. Michael Behe, Darwin's Black Box.
Okay, cockshite, let's take a look at these four pillars of piss and then I'll get back to you. The Mystery of Life's Origins is published by the Foundation for Thought and Ethics, a Christian non-profit based in, surprise, surprise, Texas. Furthermore, Thaxton was the editor of the first edition of Pandas and People, the intelligent design propaganda tract that was proven in court to be a blatant rewrite of a previously overt creationist handbook. Darwin on Trial is written by a lawyer, and according to Eugenie Scott, the director of the National Center for Science Education, teaches little that is accurate about either the nature of science or the topic of evolution. It is recommended neither by scientists nor educators. Evolution, A Theory in Crisis, while written by a biochemist, Michael Denton, has been extensively eviscerated by the scientific community. This is a perfect example of why credentials don't always translate to competence. William Lane Craig, I'd posit, being another. I, for example, don't expect people to take my PhD as a sign of infallibility and encourage them to verify my claims themselves. It appears that Mr. Craig doesn't share this sentiment. Finally, what's left to say about Behe and his book that I haven't already said about Denton? Oh yeah, I know. In addition to being panned by all the members of his department at Lehigh University and almost the entire biological research community, poor old Michael and his ideas on irreducible complexity were even found guilty of horseshit in the first degree by a federal judge who happens to be a conservative Christian. So there we have it, the sum total of Billy Boy's source material. Not a shred of real evidence from the opposing view, not one piece of peer-reviewed scientific literature. And the most appalling thing is that this is coming from someone who claims to be an academic when it appears that he's nothing of the sort, and instead a disgrace to the word and all that it stands for. And just to nail that home, just to show how little Mr. Craig knows about the subject on which he's hanging his rapidly shriveling credibility, just listen to this.
When you think that the age of the Earth itself is probably 5 to 6 billion years old.
Probably 5 to 6 billion years old? Try 4.54 billion years plus or minus 40 million or so, fucktard. And that wasn't a slip of the tongue either, because he repeated it elsewhere in the podcast. Now, I know that this might seem like a minor point, but don't you think, cockshite, that you should use a little more caution when taking the word of an imbecile who can be so wrong about such a simple fact? Obviously not, because you swallowed what he was spurting like a starving dog let loose in a wiener factory. So let's get back on track and see exactly what you took away from this festering epitome of creationist dishonesty.
Do you know that scientists are coming out all over the world admitting that evolution has some serious errors? In fact, they're now saying that macroevolution has yet to be proven and the fossil record is embarrassingly lacking. In fact, with all the species that we have of animals, we should have not just thousands, but millions and millions of fossils that show that all these animals are transitioning.
If by scientists you mean the collection of misfits and unqualified charlatans who wrote the supposed references used by your intellectual prostitute, then you might have a point. Of course, if you'd done some real research, you'd have found that there's no controversy in the real scientific community over the veracity of evolutionary theory, and any disagreements that exist are over the minutiae of how, and not the convincingly answered question of if. Macroevolution has been proven irrespectively of what you, Craig, or any other passing dishonest tosser has to say about the state of the fossil record. From the concordant nested hierarchies derived from both morphological and molecular analyses, the patterns of endogenous retrovirus distribution, The existence and equally importantly the phyletic distribution of atavisms and vestigial organs and many other equally robust lines of evidence, macroevolution has been demonstrated to as high a level of certainty as the scientific method allows. And not only that, it's also been observed. Numerous speciation events in both plants and animals have been described, confirmed, and documented in the literature, as has the phenomenon of ring speciation, whose existence can be exquisitely explained in the framework of evolutionary theory without invoking either magic or clandestine genies with serious insecurity issues. And as for your claim with regard to the perceived paucity of the fossil record, well, that comes to you straight from William Lane Craig's arse, possibly after having been lovingly placed there by one of the authors of those trashy novels he seems to be so fond of. The reality is that geologists and paleontologists have long known that fossilization is an exceedingly rare event for a number of biological and physical reasons. This isn't a big secret, and you can find out what those reasons are by reading some real scientific literature instead of listening to dishonest, mentally flatulent toads. In fact, using parameters determined from empirical observation and experiment, it's been calculated that only approximately 1% of all extinct species have been preserved in the fossil record, and most of these have been sparsely represented at best. Now, you could still argue that this 1% should contain millions of species, and if that's what Billy Boy was alluding to, then the number you'd expect to find would come down to exactly what you mean by a transitional fossil. In reality, all species are transitional forms, but closely related individuals can usually only be distinguished by experts with years of training in a given specialized area of paleontology. These individuals might well be able to distinguish a series of transitional forms in, say, a series of Miocene bivalves, while tards like you, cockshite, and your pal Bill would turn your nose up at them, and in the arrogance born of your seemingly infinite self-imposed ignorance, declare them all to be just clams. The more dramatic transitional forms that even delusional nutjobs like you have trouble denying are between the major evolutionary lineages, which number in the thousands to tens of thousands. Take 1% of that, and where are your millions of fossils now, cockshite? And just to prove my point, listen to this.
No one's arguing that there's a few examples, but we really should have millions and millions of examples of transitional species if we are to believe that macroevolution is true.
Apparently, cockshite, you're behind the times, because I've heard countless other ignorant fuckwits argue that there are absolutely no such examples. Of course, I'm not surprised you said this, because you're simply parroting your boy toy Bill again, almost verbatim. The only thing you left out was the particular fossil he gave as an example. Can anyone guess what it was? That's right, Archaeopteryx. I think this illuminates my point perfectly. If this is the only kind of transitional fossil you're willing to acknowledge, then by definition you'll find them extremely rare. The dishonesty or downright stupidity of this argument jumps starkly into focus here, because in effect the creationist cretin is saying, evolution must be false because we're missing millions of fossils where we should be finding thousands. Anyway, even with this in mind, you're still wrong, because the scientific literature is positively teeming with reports of transitional fossils that have been verified and accepted by the leading experts in their fields. Hardly the handful that your dipshit friend would have you and his flock believe, eh, cockshite? And by the way, don't think that it escaped my notice that your mate Billy admitted that transitional fossils do exist. I found that particularly interesting, cockshite, because it implies that even pathologically delusional fuckers like him must be coming to realize that they're looking like world-class morons by denying what's obvious to even an average kindergartner. And if you'd paused for thought for a moment before just regurgitating his festering intellectual vomit, you might have realized it too.
Listen to this right here, how evolution drove me, an ex-atheist, to now believe in God as a Christian.
Of course, there are two major flaws here, cockshite, so I'm going to wrap up by pointing them out so you can go and find yourself a bucket of ice. Firstly, if you think that anyone believes that you're an ex-atheist, along with the presumably fictional friends you mention elsewhere, then you must think we're as stupid as you are. But I suppose I shouldn't be surprised. If you can't grasp the simple concept that asking someone to justify the accuracy of a position that makes no positive claims is meaningless, then I suppose it's too much to ask for you to realize that not everyone is operating under the same cognitive disadvantage as you are. Secondly, the evidence you presented in this video and Billy's podcast conclusively prove that you haven't spent a moment studying evolution, but rather a sickly, stunted parody of it being peddled by a bunch of the lowest, dishonest, scum-sucking shitbags imaginable. Asking lowlives like William Lane Craig for their opinion on evolutionary theory is about as likely to lead to a fair and balanced view on the subject as asking the CEO of BP whether offshore drilling is beneficial to marine ecosystems. So hold on to that thought for a moment, cockshite, because you and anyone unfortunate enough to come across the insidious misinformation you're spreading over YouTube like a slick of malodorous sewage would be well advised to bear in mind that old IT maxim: garbage in, garbage out. This is a response to Berean Beacon's video, Termites Place Hex on Evolution. But before I begin, I'd like to correct a couple of gross oversights from Holy Hallucinations 21, where I neglected to mention a pair of great YouTubers who produce material in the areas of philosophy and theology. So if you haven't yet been exposed to the fascinating and educational videos of philosophy professor Sisyphus Redeemed or the eloquent and beautiful deconversion and theological productions of Evidence, then you really should head over to their channels and click the yellow button. But now back to the subject of this episode, and that's the user Berean Beacon and one particular example of the seemingly endless feast of televisual craptitude that you can find on his channel. I'll be referring to you as BB for the purposes of this response, so I hope you don't take offense, but if you do feel so inclined, then I'd hold off until you see the rest of the video, because I can assure you that my little nickname for you is going to be the least of your worries. Like many of your videos, this one features an episode of the anti-science radio show Creation Moments featuring a feeble-minded geriatric creationist named Ian Taylor. It seems Mr. Taylor's sole qualifications for disparaging evolutionary biology are an undergraduate degree in metallurgy and the willingness and ability to lie like the Pope at an HIV prevention workshop. But lest I be accused of indulging in baseless ad hominem attacks, let's take a look at what the old fossil had to say about the evolution of termites, and then I'll explain exactly why he's either talking straight out of his arse or has his head stuck up it.
The nest was discovered in fossilized wood from Big Bend National Park in Texas. Other scientists examined the grains under a microscope and found that they were hexagonal in shape. That distinctive shape told them that the grains were termite droppings. And these droppings were identical to those made by modern termites. With this discovery, the holes in the fossilized wood suddenly made sense.
It's hardly surprising, of course, to hear a creationist talking crap, because sometimes it seems that that's all they're capable of doing when placed in front of a microphone. The discovery that your rationally challenged friend's referring to was published by David Rohr and colleagues in the peer-reviewed journal Geology in January 1987. The fact that this particular episode of Creation Moments was broadcast in March of 2011 is a testament to the breathtakingly fast pace at the cutting edge of modern creation research. Now, on the whole, Taylor makes a reasonable summary of this part of the paper apart from his description of the fossilized frass as being identical to that of modern termites. The authors of the actual paper do make an argument that the droppings are termitic in origin because amongst extant insects, only termites and roaches produce hexagonal droppings. They argue against the possibility that the frass was produced by roaches, firstly because the pellets were too small, secondly because modern wood-boring roaches prefer to live in rotting wood and the petrified specimen in question appear to be sound, and finally because of the similarity of the distribution of the fossilized frass within the wood to that of modern origin. At no point, however, do the authors state that the frass is identical to extant termite fecal pellets, which begs the question as to why this shriveled old fart said they did. I suspect that what he was doing was opening the gate to prepare the way for him to drive through his muck spreader and really start spraying his shite. But before we see him completely lying his nuts off for Jesus, let's watch him as he starts up his tractor.
The wood had been tunneled out in the same way that modern termites tunnel wood. The nest was in the center of the wood, just as modern termites build their nests. These ancient termites had placed their droppings around the edge of the nest. Modern termites do the same thing, to plug any air leaks and prevent drafts. In short, every evidence says that termites from the time of the dinosaurs were built just like modern termites, and that they behaved in the same way as modern termites.
Once again, our budding manure magnate deliberately overstates the case. Nothing in the paper in any way says implicitly or explicitly that the insects in question were built just like modern termites. In fact, in their conclusions, the authors clearly state, and I quote, "Because the material reported here is in the form of trace fossils and no termites were preserved with the frass, it is impossible to definitely prove that termites were responsible." Now, the authors do indeed argue that termites were responsible for both the nest and the frass, and that this fossil is the oldest known example of both. And they also contend that this specimen represents one of the earliest pieces of evidence of social behavior in insects. However, arguing and contending are very much different to stating as fact, and while these authors do point to similarities between various aspects of these remains and their extant counterparts, they never claim that they're identical because they don't have the evidence to justify doing so. In fact, it's very interesting just to compare the language used by this creationist cretin and the scientist whose words he's mining like a dung beetle that's just discovered an elephant's outhouse. While Rohr and colleagues, like all good scientists, use more circumspect and intellectually honest language when putting forward their interpretations of the evidence, Taylor resorts to the dogmatic absolutism of the religious zealot who, certain of the infallible truth of his scripture, can't even conceive of the possibility of being wrong. At no stage did the paper say anything about the morphology of these animals themselves, but it appears that this wrinkled old prune doesn't feel in any way restrained by such trivialities as common decency or the facts. It seems that Mr. Taylor is either demonstrating the true value of his metallurgy degree in the area of evolutionary paleobiology, or merely being a compulsive liar. Of course, he is a creationist apologist, so perhaps I shouldn't be surprised. So with all that said, I'd love to ask this stupid old bastard exactly which of the more than 2,000 species of extant termites he thinks these invisible fossils are just like. That comment alone speaks volumes about the childish and simplistic mind that we're dealing with here. And now let's get back to the question of why Farmer Taylor is so insistent on misrepresenting the physical evidence. So now that he's fired up his John Deere, let's take a look at what he's planning to do with it.
That there is no evidence of any termite evolution in this nest agrees perfectly with the Bible's claim that all things reproduce after their kind.
And there we have it. With this devious sleight of hand, the creatard claims that these ancient termites that weren't actually in the fossil, that produced similar fecal pellets and that behaved in a similar manner, are in fact the same as termites that are alive today, and so evolution must not occur. One can only wonder whether he read the same paper I did, or whether he read it at all. And so a 65-million-year-old fossil that was found in a late Cretaceous formation and in itself conclusively negates biblical creation and a young earth is, with a generous dollop of dishonesty, a liberal sprinkling of sophistry and a side dish of reprehensible lies, served up as proof positive for the Abrahamic creation myth. And here I've been for the past year arguing that there's no such thing as magic. Of course, there's nothing new here, just a rehashing of the same dismal failed arguments we've heard time and time again with organisms such as crinoids, various mollusks, shrimp, plants, and of course coelacanths, otherwise colloquially known as living fossils. All your deceptive little muckraker's done is substitute the word termite as an excuse to spew out the same old pathetically unconvincing bullshit. This argument, of course, completely ignores the well-documented concept of evolutionary stasis. It's been clearly understood for decades that evolutionary lineages can and do remain relatively stable morphologically over periods of millions of years in the absence of dramatic changes in selective pressures. This stasis is maintained at least in part by the statistical stabilization of gene pools in large populations by allele dilution and gene flow, although the exact contributions of these and other factors are the subject of active debate and research by today's evolutionary biologists. Thus, given a sufficiently large breeding population and a sufficiently stable environment, evolutionary theory easily accounts for phenotypic persistence, be it in snails or shrimp or fish or termites. However, over longer periods of time, even this persistence of phenotypes begins to apply only to gross morphology. Zoologists and paleontologists with the appropriate training and experience are able to easily distinguish similar species within the fossil record and to differentiate extant species from their extinct relatives, even creating mathematical algorithms to quantify these differences. Of course, none of this matters to the fatuous creatards who try to propound this stunted and sickly runt of an argument in its many forms. The fact that this concept has been explained countless times does nothing to prevent them from gleefully interpreting stasis as an absence of any evolutionary process at all, presumably by conceitedly using a maxim along the lines of, "It looks the same to my ignorant and untrained eye, so it is the same." By way of an example, let me quote from a random paper I selected on trilobite morphology that demonstrates the detail and precision used by a trained professional. Granulation is coarsest on the posterior half of the axial rings, on the glabella and cheeks, and on the pleural ribs of the thorax and pygidium. Furrows are finely granulated to smooth. In contrast, the creationists who make these arguments about living fossils essentially simply just assert the lack of any evolutionary change with no evidence or argument and no reference to any specific specimens or morphological features. Essentially, the best they can do is, "Sure looks the same, don't it?" That might impress you, BB, but it elicits an entirely different response from anyone who can tell the difference between a laboratory and a lobotomy. Now, before I wrap up this section, let's get back to the subject of termites so I can show you what a little real research can do. Based on morphological analyses of extant species and on the fossil record, it's been long accepted that termites and cockroaches are descended from a common roach-like ancestor. Unsurprisingly, more recent DNA analysis has confirmed this to be the case, providing three independent verifications of the evolutionary relationships of these insects. Additionally, Mastertermes darwiniensis, the most roach-like of the termites, is the only one that carries an endosymbiotic bacterium that's common to all cockroaches. Researchers predicted that these bladder bacteria should have co-evolved with their hosts and recently conducted a molecular analysis of a number of roaches and this termite and their respective microbial symbionts. The resulting phylogenies of both insects and bacteria were almost identical and provided a breathtaking validation of evolutionary theory, for only evolution both predicted and provides an explanation for the convergence of these cladograms. This is just one example of the countless equally impressive pieces of evidence that all converge inexorably to the same conclusion, that evolution is a fact that is beautifully explained by the theory of the same name, regardless of what cretins like Ian Taylor have to say about it. And if he doesn't like it, then he can stick it up his compost heap. So now that I've dealt with that, it's time to turn my attention back to you, BB. I have to say that I initially found the second half of your video a little surreal, as it was, to put it mildly, a bit of a non sequitur. I'm not sure whether this was an editing error on your part or merely a sign of a short attention span, but you changed the subject faster than William Lane Craig after an honest question. So let's do the same thing and take a look at what you had to say about that stale and rancid puddle of creationist vomit known as the Life Science Prize.
They could easily shut down us creationists by simply taking Dr. Mastropoulos' challenge and defeat him. If they have any evidence, they could bring us to an embarrassing halt as creationists. They could silence our voice. They could make us look like morons.
Of course, it wouldn't take a scientist accepting this challenge to make creationists look like morons, because they've been doing a bang-up job of that themselves for over a century. And if you don't believe me, then just take a look at some of the many fine examples of stupendous fuckwittery from your fellow mentally castrated intellectual eunuchs right here on YouTube. So now, let's get back to the challenge. Firstly, let me point out that your faith in your apparent hero, Joseph Mastropoulos, is as misplaced as your faith in your pitifully childish and patently fallacious fairy tales. You see, it seems that the good doctor is a kinesiologist with a PhD in the field, although according to his entry in Creation Wiki, not a particularly good one, since his record of 6 peer-reviewed publications in an academic career of over 26 years is about as impressive as a pair of hamster testicles dangling off a bull elephant. So while this may qualify him to comment on the correct posture for a creationist to adopt while talking endless wank to avoid a case of terminal brain strain, it hardly fosters confidence in his ability to debate the veracity of evolutionary theory with even a moderately qualified biologist. I strongly suspect that if such a debate ever took place, he'd be picking the shrapnel out of his ass for a year afterwards. Secondly, it took me just 5 minutes to find 2 published accounts of exactly how Mastropoulos and his slimy henchmen reacted when biology professors Michael Zimmerman and none other than Richard Dawkins probed them by pretending to be interested in a debate. It was more than amusing to read how their enthusiasm dried up faster than a suspicious stain on a priest's trousers after choir practice when anyone even vaguely resembling an unbiased and/or qualified adjudicator was suggested. The desperation in their frenzied attempts to extricate themselves from the possibility of being called on their bullshit was nothing short of palpable despite the liberal seasoning of false bravado. From just these two accounts, it should be more than blindingly obvious to anyone whose brain isn't seeping out of their anal sphincter that Mastro Paolo has no intention in participating in a debate. This particularly odious and dishonest little reptile uses the facade of a genuine challenge to publicize his intellectually indefensible position, and this is no more evident than the fact that anyone who declines to participate in his charade is automatically adjudged to have lost the debate by default. As a result, he's collected more so-called victories than an evangelical preacher has venereal diseases and proudly displays his dishonesty on his webpage, presumably either because he's too stupid to realize exactly how big a douchebag this makes him look like, or because he thinks it's okay to be a lying tosspot as long as you're doing it for Jesus. So aside from this being a tactic I might expect from an intellectually subnormal fifth grader, it's also one of the most underhanded and reprehensible kinds of behavior imaginable. If this is the kind of lying pustule you need to fall back on to cling onto your primitive superstitions, BB, then perhaps you need to ask yourself whether they're really worth clinging to. Because from where I'm standing, it appears that you're tossing the very things your religion is supposed to stand for into the same cesspit that Joseph Mastropaolo is wallowing in.
They don't do it because the rules for the Life Science Prize restrict them to real science, not propaganda, not the power of the pulpit. They also have many pulpits in their favor, not the power of the headlines. They're restricted to science, and that's why they won't contend for the Life Science Prize.
So presumably it was this fear of debating real science that compelled Michael Zimmerman to suggest that the judge be at least a member of the National Academy of Sciences. Presumably this is also why he suggested a definition of evolution, that is, change in allele frequency over time that has been in virtually, and I quote, every biology textbook for the past half century. Scared of science, BB? Really? If your Dr. Douchebag was so keen to debate science, then can you explain why he wouldn't accept these quite reasonable terms? Why he insisted that this scientific debate could only be adjudicated by a superior court judge? Better still, can you explain why he wouldn't even accept Zimmerman's suggestion of using an ordained priest, Dr. Francisco Ayala, as a judge? Could it be that it was because Ayala is a past president of the American Association for the Advancement of Science and a member of the National Academy? Could it be that Mastropaolo didn't explain why Ayala was unacceptable because he was too busy browning his keks at the prospect of being shown up for what he really is? So you see, BB, if by science you mean what every sane and rational human being on the planet understands by that word, then it's pretty clear that the only one avoiding a debate on it is your Dr. Dickhead. If, on the other hand, by science you mean that hazy, ill-defined concept that seems to roughly approximate to anything that conflicts with my delusional belief system, you know, the same usage that I've heard coming from such monumental YouTube fucktards as Nephilim Free and I2I35, then you might have a point. Because at the end of the day, working scientists have much better and more productive things to do with their time than pandering to the hallucinations of a bunch of feeble-minded, deceitful simpletons. So quite frankly, BB, you and Joseph Mastropaolo can take your pathetic and transparently dishonest little challenge and stick it back up where it belongs to keep it safe and warm. Because all you're doing by parading it around so proudly in public is demonstrating quite clearly how your beacon is running on only a 5-watt bulb. Before I begin this latest installment of Crude But Creative Creationist Castration, I'd like to mention the slight change you might have noticed at the beginning of this video. In this respect, I'd like to sincerely thank my recently acquired friend and fellow YouTuber One Species for kindly creating my spectacular new intro sequence. He's a motion graphics professional and produces, quite frankly, some of the most visually stunning and thought-provoking videos on YouTube. If you're as yet unaware of him, I strongly suggest you stop watching this crap immediately and head over to his channel and watch a real artist at work. Now, to mark this occasion, I've not only revamped the title text to this series, but I've also taken a slightly different tack in this episode. So instead of addressing a creationist video, this will be a response to a comment left on Holy Hallucinations 24 by the user AnswerQuestions1, who I'll be referring to as AQ. So let's take a look at what it was that provided me with the inspiration to make this video. The problem with phylogeny ERVs, vestigial organs, and all the supposed evidence that you mention is that none of the arguments is falsifiable. Evolution can and always will adapt to any discovery made. My initial reaction was to begin typing out an explanation as to why, in true creationist style, you were belching the most incredibly malodorous and noxious fallacies. However, as I was collecting my thoughts and preparing to ram them vigorously up your bunghole, it suddenly occurred to me that your comment was possibly worthy of some special attention. So instead of giving you my opinion on your ideas in writing, I instead responded with this. You are quite spectacularly in error. It'll be impossible for me to explain why in 500 characters, so I will consider making a video on the matter as it will also prove to be quite educational. Now, my initial intent was to mainly delineate exactly how these various lines of evidence could be falsified, when a subsequent exchange you had with another user made me realize that you were so high on Jesus juice-fueled paranoia that I also needed to address the second part of your comment to prevent you from dismissing what I had to say out of hand. And here's a prime example of what I'm talking about. My point is that evolutionists will use the interpretation that better fits their model. If they predict an old age, then all the factors that indicate a young age will be due to contamination, and if they predict a young age, then all the factors that indicate an old age will be due to contamination. This, of course, is essentially a rehashing of the old creationist assertion that the grown-ups that they refer to as evolutionists, and I prefer to call scientists, interpret physical evidence to exclusively reflect their pre-established worldview of godless change in allele frequency over time. I've addressed this particular colostomy bag of an argument a number of times before, most notably with Carl Gallup's that infamous lying nutsack of an excuse for a man whose seemingly endless cranial flatulence is primarily responsible for the stench emanating from the P.P. Simmons YouTube channel. Nevertheless, I think there is more that I can add to what I've already said, and since this attitude seems to form the basis of your initial comment, I think the time taken to elaborate further here will be well spent before getting back to the specifics of the evidence you're denying. But before I begin, I want to point out a fundamental error in a staggeringly naive assumption that you and many other creationists seem to take for granted. You see, you appear to be laboring under the misapprehension that if evolution were disproved tomorrow, that this would somehow validate your particular creation fable. Unfortunately, the reality is that it would still remain what it's always been, a steaming turd on the soul of the history of human thought, because it's been conclusively disproved countless times by observations in fields as diverse as geology, cosmology, and nuclear physics. So with that aside, let's get back to the matter in hand. I'll begin by saying that it's been shown that over 30% of scientists actually believe in God. And since this survey was conducted in the United States, I think we can safely say that this is probably the same narcissistic yet strangely elusive genocidal maniac depicted in the book that you used to justify your refusal to embrace the mental state the rest of us call sanity. The difference between them and your kind, of course, is that these individuals see the world as being a little more complex than a child's coloring book. They have both a respect for the truth over their own fragile egos and also an aversion to making delusional twats of themselves in public, and so have found a way of incorporating a healthy dose of reality into their beliefs. Since it would be perfectly consistent with these beliefs, I don't doubt that these rational theistic scientists would have any problem in embracing your simplistic and juvenile worldview should it actually be supported by a little thing called any fucking evidence at all. Unfortunately for creationists, this large group of scientifically literate theists has yet to make any objections to evolutionary theory despite their worldview not being subject to the same restrictions that you and your kind claim the atheists is. If the evidence were really there, then there are plenty of honest, properly trained theists out there who'd be happy to use it. In any case, even if all the scientists in the world were atheists, it wouldn't make a difference. I've heard it said many times on YouTube, but I want to reiterate it here. Science is a cutthroat business and glittering careers are made by discovering new phenomena, the explanation of existing phenomena, and the overturn of current theories by improved ones. The halls of academia are positively festooned with ambitious researchers who would be willing to sacrifice either tits or testicles for an opportunity to prove evolution wrong, regardless of the philosophical or theological consequences. the desire for recognition, for the plaudits and admiration of their peers, for financial reward and success, and to be the first or best are just as strong in these individuals as in any person on the planet. In fact, it's a testament to the strength of the scientific method that despite such powerful motivations, evidence against evolution isn't being produced on a daily basis. You see, in religion, any old lying shitbag can claim that their god gives them a personal nightly rim job in the hope that enough gullible peasants will be willing to keep him supplied in all the prostitutes and coke he desires, all done in the safe knowledge that no one will be able to produce any empirical evidence to call him on his bullshit. In contrast, scientists aren't afforded this luxury because they know that their data will be scrutinized by hosts of their peers and that frauds will be mercilessly rooted out, publicly humiliated, and permanently banished. So the absurdity of thinking that so many people with all too human needs, ambitions, and desires would for some reason, as a single body, somehow decide to forego them in order to defend an abstract explanatory construct, even if they knew it to be wrong, is quite simply mind-boggling. Of course, you and your fellow conspiracy nutcases are essentially asserting that this is exactly what's happening in your comments stating that incompatible facts are bent to fit theory. So now I'm going to take a moment to explain to you how science is actually conducted, and as I do so, please bear in mind that I've been an active researcher for over 20 years now, and so, unlike you, I'm speaking out of personal experience and not straight out of my ass. All new experimental and observational data are always interpreted in the light of the current theoretical paradigm of the applicable field of research. This approach is used because it's somewhat more efficient in evaluating all conceivable possible interpretations, from the involvement of microscopic sexually depraved fairies to invisible omnipotent peeping toms. Even though you seem to think it should be otherwise, observations that don't fit current theory don't result in its immediate trashing and the adoption of the baseless speculations of the first passing delusional fucktard with an opinion. Instead, such observations are repeatedly verified to confirm that they aren't the result of statistical or experimental error, and if this proves not to be the case, theory is modified, if possible, to explain the new results. Such modifications are then used to make predictions, and these predictions are further tested to determine whether the modified theory is viable or whether alternative possibilities need to be considered. Inability to produce a comprehensive theory that encompasses the new result doesn't, however, automatically justify its wholesale abandonment in favor of delusional, untested, and untestable alternatives. A perfect example is Newton's theory of gravity. It was long known that this inadequately explained certain perturbations in the orbit of Mercury. However, this didn't result in the dismissal of concepts such as action at a distance and the inverse square law for the assertion that God was sitting on the sun in his skivvies and a coating of SPF 7 trillion, twirling the planets around his head on invisible strings. Instead, this inexplicable discrepancy was duly noted and the theory accepted as being imperfect or incomplete. Nevertheless, in the absence of anything better, Newtonian gravitation remained the best accepted explanation, good enough in fact to send mankind to the moon and back until Einstein finally developed a solution in his general theory of relativity. This is exactly why evolutionary theory has been modified over the past century to incorporate concepts such as genetic drift, punctuated equilibria, and various modes of speciation. However, to date, no alternative has been developed because nobody's been able to produce a cohesive and self-consistent framework that explains observable reality as exquisitely as biological evolution, or that can compete with its quite stunning predictive power. Now, AQ, I'm already hearing you protest.
But wait, I hear you say, there is plenty of evidence that counters evolution. It is just ignored or twisted to fit.
I say this because you yourself mentioned two supposed lines of evidence in your comment exchange, that of the alleged discovery of both pollen and human artifacts in the Precambrian. Because of time constraints, I'm not going to go into exactly why these demonstrate either your laughably low standards for accepting evidence or your complete ignorance of what's acceptable scientifically. To be honest, though, I suspect that the former is more applicable because when you were challenged by two different people to provide bona fide peer-reviewed sources for these claims, rather than doing so, you tucked your tail between your legs and fucked off faster than a priest slipping his hand up a choir boy's robe, and we haven't seen hide or hair of you since. The fact that you didn't bother to mention the pathetically shoddy sources of your so-called evidence strongly suggests that you are fully aware of how pitiful it actually is.
In that case, the fact that you presented it at all makes me seriously wonder whether I shouldn't be addressing you as a whole and not a cue. Now, I realize that you're unlikely to accept or believe any of this preceding narrative, and of course it's a little difficult to provide documentary evidence for it. As a second opinion, I'd therefore like to quote a passage by Mark Norell, the curator of fossil reptiles, amphibians, and birds at the American Museum of Natural History, from his book Unearthing the Dragon. Any real systematist or scientist in general has to be ready to heave all he or she has believed in, consider it crap, and move on in the face of new evidence. That is how we differ from clerics. Of course, I've little doubt that Dr. Norell would be accused of being as biased as I'm sure you're accusing me of being as you watch this, so lest you or any other creationist be tempted to dismiss what I've said out of hand, I'd also like you to ponder for a moment on the following. In the 400 years since the birth of empirical naturalism, the very same science and scientific method that has developed evolutionary theory has also led us from curing diseases with leeches to preventing them using microscopic entities that can't even be discerned by the naked eye. It has taken us from communicating with each other over periods of weeks or months using parchment and quill to instantly sending messages that ride the gulfs between us on sunbeams. And it's taken us from navigating our planet on ships of wood and cloth to sailing across vast expanses of nothingness to explore alien worlds that were previously simply unimagined and unimaginable. This is what speaks to the veracity of what I've said, and if you compare it to what's been produced by the motley collection of repugnant liars, deceitful charlatans, and mentally subnormal simpletons that you choose to get your information from, information that's been demonstrated repeatedly and indisputably to be nothing but a series of out-and-out frauds, deliberate falsehoods, and blatant misrepresentations, well, I know which I'd be putting my money on. So now that I've laid out the case against your general objection to the evidence supporting evolutionary theory, I'm going to get back to your original comment and explain why the specific lines of evidence I mentioned are indeed falsifiable, and why you're talking directly out of an orifice whose intended function, while equally malodorous, is somewhat less repulsive. I don't think many creationists appreciate that the very fact that all extant and extinct species can be objectively classified in a consistent nested hierarchy at all is itself almost incontrovertible evidence that they arose via evolution. That's because mathematically the only known mechanism for generating such hierarchies are branching evolutionary processes. This in itself provides the creationist with the opportunity to, if not formally disprove evolutionary theory, at least propose a serious alternative to explain this pattern. All our grown-up wannabes need to do is describe an alternative process that produces such hierarchies, instead of spending their time less productively by belching out lies by the ton and flogging strawmen as severely as their limited intellects allow. I, for one, though, am not holding my breath. In addition, it's often underappreciated how quantitative phylogenetics actually is. Since Willi Hennig first proposed placing the discipline on a quantitative level by classifying organisms via their shared derived characteristics or synapomorphies, it's become possible to produce objective phylogenetic trees by computationally maximizing the number of shared characters while minimizing the number of conflicts. It's for this reason that cladistic methods identify bats as mammals, with which they share the vast number of characters, and not as the birds that the ignorant goat shaggers who wrote the book that you're desperately trying to push as unquestionable facts seem to think they were. The fact that using these methods on hundreds of morphological characteristics as well as independently on countless DNA sequences generates essentially the same cladograms, once again screams to anyone who hasn't got their head firmly lodged inside the sweaty crevice between their buttocks that evolutionary processes are at work. So, AQ. It should be pretty clear from this that it's perfectly possible to falsify evolution by identifying an animal or group of animals that conflict irreconcilably with this hierarchy, and you can forget about what you said regarding evolutionists using whatever interpretation best fits their model, because this isn't a matter of opinion, it's a matter of statistically quantifiable and verifiable reality. So rather than spending your time sharing your opinion by verbally defecating on my comments page, I strongly suggest you instead either go and find such evidence, or shut the fuck up.
ERVs are inherited in the same way as derived characters and DNA sequences and can therefore be used to generate phylogenetic trees that are concordant with those produced by sequence and morphological analyses. Again, finding patterns of ERV distribution in known or newly discovered species that conflict with this pattern will pose a serious problem for evolutionary theory. At present, GenBank, the worldwide repository of DNA sequence information, contains over 100 billion base pairs and is growing exponentially at a rate of about 20 billion a year. It seems to me, therefore, that rather than wasting your time sharing your ignorant opinions on YouTube, you'd be much better off investing it in searching this freely available and rapidly growing database for sequences that conflict with the evolutionary model. And if this seems like a little too much effort, then perhaps you'll instead just shut the fuck up. One of the underappreciated aspects of both molecular sequence and morphological vestiges and of atavisms is not only where they appear but also where they don't, because their distribution within the species fits into the nested hierarchy with remarkable consistency. In other words, both atavisms and vestiges appear only in lineages whose common ancestor possessed the characteristic in question. Conversely, they've never been found in groups that don't contain a basal character from which they were derived. As a result, we have never seen bones or their remnants present or appearing in invertebrates, nor cellulose walls in animal cells. In contrast, we found teeth and the genes that drive their development in birds and observed humans born with semi-functional tails. Thus, evolutionary theory predicts that we will never find, for example, boobs on boas or tits on toads as either atavisms or vestiges, because mammary glands developed only after the appearance of reptiles and amphibians. Your task, AQ, is therefore relatively simple. All you have to do is find a taxon or two that contain members that bear a vestige or have been documented to produce an atavism that could not have been derived from a character in a basal ancestor, and you'll have hammered a seriously big nail into the coffin of evolutionary theory. Of course, I don't really expect you to do any of this, because the track record of creationists is to smugly sit on the sidelines rubbishing the work of others, while making up outrageous lies or retarded hypotheses instead of doing what's actually required to back up their ludicrous and infantile little claims. After all, that's so much easier than getting a relevant education, doing some actual fucking work, and taking the risk of proving yourself wrong, isn't it, AQ? So now that I've explained some of the ways in which it could happen, if you don't intend to do any of these things, I really would prefer not to have to read any more of your ignorant and deceitful opinions, and would respectfully like to ask you to please just shut the fuck up. This is a response to P.P. Simmons' video, Evolution, Settled Science or a Magic Man in the Mud. Hello again, Carl. Long time no see. I have to say that your uncharacteristic silence on the subject of evolution following the serial scholastic butt-fucking I gave you in Holy Hallucinations 15 through 18 had me thinking that you'd given up on science denialism. I was therefore a little surprised when I found out that you produced the aforementioned video, but nevertheless delighted, because while I can't explain it, there are few creationists that I enjoy beating the shit out of with the baseball bat of reason more than you. In fact, I was so delighted that I rushed over to your comments page to leave you a little thank you note. Now call me a tad naive if you must, but I was a little taken aback to find out that I was unable to do so because it appeared that you had inexplicably blocked me from your channel. Of course, I dearly wanted you to know that I hadn't forgotten about you or my vow to respond to any of your future rectal expulsions, so I took the liberty of posting a bulletin to my subscribers asking if anyone could pass on my best wishes. Needless to say, a large number of them kindly proceeded to do so, and before long I think the message was coming through to you loud and clear. In fact, it's a lucky thing I happened to be on the comments page watching the waves rolling in when I noticed these comments suddenly starting to disappear like popping soap bubbles. Fortunately, despite my being busy pissing my pants with laughter at the time, I had the presence of mind to save a copy of the page before your trained monkeys decided that being chicken shit was the better part of valor, and pulled the plug by taking down the page entirely and heading for the hills. So I'd like to sincerely thank all my subscribers who took the time to make sure that Carl and his special friends at the P.P. Simmons channel were made fully aware of what they were about to receive,
and for that I'm sure that they're forever thankful. And as for you, Carl, might I suggest that you go and find something to bite down on while I play the first clip from your video, because I think I can safely say that this is gonna make you wince.
Of course, the evolutionist has to declare that evolution is a settled scientific fact, because any less of a declaration at least leaves room for the possibility of an intelligent designer, and or, blasphemies of all blasphemies, the Genesis account of the Bible and the Christian faith.
I'll get to your mischaracterization of the word fact in the next segment, Carl, but let's get one thing straight here from the outset. When you or any other creationist uses the term intelligent designer, we all know that it's a euphemism for my God. So don't try slipping that in there to make yourself look like you have an open mind, because everyone who's watched just one or two of your videos will know that yours is closed tighter than Kent Hovind's buttocks at shower time. And with regard to your Genesis account, it's funny how you neglected to mention any of the thousands of other creation fables out there and their associated deities, each one of which has exactly the same amount of evidentiary support behind it that yours does and therefore is every bit as likely to be true. So unless you can produce a talking snake, or demonstrate how to clone a female sex pot out of a human male rib, or explain how you can produce a viable gene pool from two individuals, or present us with physical and verifiable evidence of the existence of your particular celestial butt buddy, then you can take your Genesis account and get to the back of the fucking line.
Is evolution a settled scientific fact? While I am willing to admit that there are several scientifically factual observations noted by the field of evolutionary study, to declare the entire field of evolutionary theory to be a settled scientific fact to the exclusion of all other possibilities of origins and the continuation of the species is at least disingenuous and at most downright dishonest.
I found it fascinating that you actually came out and admitted that there are several scientifically factual observations noted by the field of evolutionary study. Does that mean, Carl, that even a pig-headed simpleton like you has come to the conclusion that brazenly denying the existence of what is patently obvious to even a five-year-old does nothing but highlight your early-onset senility? Of course, you haven't shared with us exactly which facts you've honored with your blessing, Carl, but I would really like to know what they are, mainly so I can explain exactly why there are thousands more examples that are equally undeniable. Nevertheless, just this admission alone leaves you on shaky ground, because as far as I'm concerned, your precious Genesis account is not supported by any facts at all, and in contrast is contradicted by millions of them coming from multiple disciplines of science, not just evolutionary biology. As a result, when it comes to possibilities other than evolution, your option is hardly at the top of the list, is it? As for the rest of this clip, in it you begin what turns out to be a running theme in this digital streak of mental diarrhea, and that is the continuous misuse of the words fact and theory and the concerted effort to justify your insincere conflation of abiogenesis and evolution. You should be aware that phrases such as the entire field of evolutionary theory are meaningless collections of words that only arrogantly ignorant morons like yourself string together to fool others into thinking that you know what you're talking about. Evolutionary theory isn't a field, it's a coherent conceptual framework of diverse mechanisms that provides an explanatory basis for the facts that have been collected by scientists working in the field of evolutionary biology. To this day, I still find it breathtaking that dullards such as yourself are so willing to go out into public and so confidently pontificate about things that you evidently don't have the first fucking clue about. So when scientists state that evolution is a fact, Carl, they're talking about facts such as the demonstration that allele frequencies in populations do indeed change over time, the verification of numerous speciation events both in the wild and in the laboratory, the observation of the appearance of new morphological features in isolated populations, and many others. Evolutionary theory, which provides a cohesive and consistent explanation of these and countless other observations, on the other hand, isn't a fact by definition, though it can be either correct or incorrect, or in most cases partially accurate. Epistemically, of course, we can never be completely sure whether any given theory is absolutely correct, but for you to hang your spiv's hat on this philosophical technicality is an act of breathtaking dishonesty. In reality, the insurmountable edifice of accumulated data on this subject makes the likelihood that evolutionary theory is, at least in broad terms, correct almost undeniable.
And while science does technically allow for the now infinitesimal possibility that this evidence might be better explained by completely unrelated mechanisms, that doesn't give any raving fucktard with a microphone and an internet connection the right to expect to have their cranial excretions taken seriously without them providing a shred of evidence in their support. If that were the case, Carl, then you should be perfectly willing to accept that your Genesis fable could equally well be supplanted by my contention that the first two human beings were shat out of a tetrasexual, pan-dimensional octopoid's asshole after a particularly heavy night of lagers and a dodgy chicken biryani. Come to think of it, that particular hypothesis may go a long way towards explaining the existence of you good folks at the P.P. Simmons channel. So these sleazy and indirect creationist arguments that seek to exploit the honesty of the scientific enterprise and its willingness, nay obligation, to continually question the status quo is nothing new, particularly when they're disingenuously coupled to examples where paradigm shifts have occurred. Of course, you're nothing if not predictable, Carl, so let's go on and look at the example of change you picked on, and why your choice elevates you to new and previously unimagined heights of complete and utter fail.
For almost 2,000 years, it was considered settled scientific fact that one of the primary mechanisms for the origins of a living organism was through spontaneous generation, or life arising spontaneously from non-life. The great philosopher and scientist Aristotle proliferated this scientific fact of his day.
And there you go again with your glib and flippant disregard for the actual meaning of words, Carl. Why is it that you think that this isn't really important, I wonder? Is it because it allows you to easily construct a straw man that you proceed to beat so gleefully with your fundy stick? Or is it because you really are so stupid as to believe that what you're saying has some meaning to those who subscribe to a worldview that encompasses the mental state known as sanity? Aristotle was, without question, a genius of colossal stature, but one who was considerably constrained by the limitations of knowledge of his time. He was also in no sense of the word a scientist, because true science arose approximately 2,000 years after his death from the ideas and writings of the likes of Francis Bacon, which were eventually implemented by Galileo Galilei in what were the first truly scientific investigations. Not being privy to this extraordinarily powerful method for investigating the physical world, Aristotle was restricted in his quest for knowledge to the philosophical and logical pondering of the implications of what he thought were obvious and self-evident facts. Of course, the fruits of any such investigation can only be as sound as the premises on which they're based, and in the example you gave here, these false premises resulted in fruits that might as well have fallen straight out of a donkey's arse. This is precisely why pure philosophy, while being wonderful in informing us in subjective matters such as how to think and behave, has a very poor track record in determining the nature of the physical world. While its products can only be as good as the assumptions that the philosopher makes, or in some cases pulls directly out of his arse, science can put these products to the test by presenting them to nature and allowing her to be the final and objective arbiter of their true worth. So you're using the word science and scientist in the context of Aristotle in order to make your loathsome insinuation that his failures are in some way comparable to the continual improvements and refinements of modern science is perhaps one of the biggest and foulest brain turds I've seen you squeeze out since I first started wading through your sewage here on YouTube.
Yet this astounding thinker and scientist was wrong on the matter of spontaneous generation. He was wrong concerning the fundamental question of life. And this is no small error. His massive miscalculation went to the foundation of life itself. Yet anyone who wished to argue for the spontaneous generation of life and the absence of a need for God could have appealed to the so-called settled scientific truth of Aristotle and his day.
That, of course, would be a great point if Aristotle's thoughts could even vaguely be considered scientific. Unfortunately, no matter how many times you assert the contrary, Carl, your dirty little lie won't become true. One more time, you dishonest little skidmark of a man. Comparing the stature and credibility of evolutionary theory, which is based on arguably the largest and most diverse body of physical evidence in the whole of science, to Aristotle's spontaneous generation, which was based on almost none at all, is like comparing the entire faculty of the Massachusetts Institute of Technology to Venom Fang X and his subpar high school education and diploma in embezzlement technology. Anyway, I think I've made my point, but before I go on, I did want to mention that I noticed two references that you put up while quoting Aristotle. I think that's a first for you, Carl, but forgive me for suggesting that this was just a cheap little ploy by you so that you could make some kind of pretension towards being academic. In the future, I'd be more impressed if you could instead cite either peer-reviewed references to support your outrageous claims or the actual sources that you happen to be frantically quote-mining so that your viewers can check your dishonesty for themselves. Otherwise, as far as I'm concerned, you can take your pointless citations and stick them up your swollen brown eye.
We now know, for a scientific fact, that life does not originate from non-life.
And as much as it pains me to say it, Carl, I actually have to agree with you. The idea of spontaneous generation was destroyed by the truly scientific investigations of individuals such as Francesco Redi, Lazzaro Spallanzani, and Louis Pasteur. These individuals dispelled beliefs that, for example, maggots arose spontaneously from rotting meat by proving empirically that no extant, and as we'll see later, I use the word for a reason, organisms can arise from non-living material but only from pre-existing life forms. Ironically for you, Carl, this observation was critical for the eventual development of evolutionary theory because the spontaneous generation of fully developed organisms from dirt, which appears to be what you as a biblical literalist are arguing for, would undermine the central concept of evolution, that is, descent with modification. So although for a change I've agreed with you on something, the reason I've taken the time to elaborate here will soon become clear because you're about to use the concept of spontaneous generation to commit the most outrageous fallacy of equivocation, or to put it another way, tell another massive stinking lie.
And so what is evolution's story for the origins of life today, some 2,000 years after Aristotle? The answer is abiogenesis or chemosynthesis. Fancy sounding words, but what do they mean? Plain and simple, the words mean this: life originated from non-living substances or non-living chemical compounds, randomly, without intelligent input or design. In other words, life originated through, wait for it, spontaneous generation.
It's become extremely difficult for me to come up with new adjectives to describe you, Carl, because every time I think you've hit rock bottom, you somehow manage to find a way to sink even further into the sewer. As a result, I'm going to have to start creating some new ones and ask you whether there are any limits to your complete and utter turdishness. The collection of hypotheses known as abiogenesis has nothing to do with spontaneous generation because it doesn't attempt to explain the sudden appearance of modern extant biota from non-living substrates. I know from some of your previous videos that you're more than aware of this, so you have no excuse for this underhanded and deliberate subterfuge. Abiogenesis outlines possible physical mechanisms for the production of the first self-replicating polymers and their assembly and sequestration within membrane-bound compartments and the development of the chemical interfaces between different biopolymeric systems. So for you to argue that the same evidence that destroyed spontaneous generation 300 years ago also applies to this new and exciting field of study is nothing short of a deliberate and outrageous brazen lie. As I said, I'm running out of adjectives for you, Carl, so perhaps I'll try a noun instead. How about shitbag?
For anyone wishing to argue that origins theory is somehow not connected to evolution theory, we would simply refer you to any college textbook on origins, or specifically to Dr. Richard Dawkins' book, The Ancestor's Tale.
And here you go again, Carl, trying so desperately to link abiogenesis to evolutionary theory so you can gleefully tar the latter with the current uncertainties inherent in the former, and then come to your preferred and predetermined conclusion, that is, my God did it. It's interesting that you've suddenly switched to this new field of science that apparently just emerged from your ring piece because I, for one, have never heard of origins theory. I have to hand it to you, Carl, that this was certainly an inventive attempt to conflate the two, but you're going to have to do a lot better to slip something like that past me or anyone else who has a nose for complete and utter bullshit. As for your textbook claim, one that you funnily enough didn't reference, my reaction is so fucking what? The fact that any given text contains discussions and descriptions of more than one topic does not mean that those topics are de facto interdependent. Based on this reasoning, could I therefore assume that you'd agree that because Playboy magazine contains both photographs of handsomely endowed young ladies as well as articles on all manner of sports, it would not be unreasonable to expect that all women who attend sporting events should do so while displaying their wobbly jubblies? Of course not, and what's relevant in this case is what science and the scientists who develop it have to say on the matter, and not the putrid lies of a dishonest tosser whose regard for the truth is as small as his desire to make a quick buck from the people who listen to his crap is large. And while those scientists agree that chemical evolutionary processes play important roles in abiogenesis, they also all agree that Darwinian biological evolution only applies to pre-existing life forms. If your metaphysical mate did happen to create life, Carl, then the evidence is overwhelming that he allowed it to diversify and flourish over billions of years via evolutionary processes. And if you're going to insist that he did it all a few thousand years ago using juju, then not only are you denigrating the magnificence of his creative vision, but also cramming him into a pathetically small and human box within the pages of a worn and threadbare book which you've chosen to worship instead of him.
So is Origins and its subsequent explanation for the continuance of the life cycle, evolution, settled scientific fact? Not by a long shot. Not even close. In fact, some of the theory is still mired in 2,000-year-old mythology. A magic man in the mud, so to speak.
You really are a slimy little fuck, Carl. You really are. A magic man in the mud? Really? That's kind of rich coming from someone who himself is seriously insisting, like some tribal shaman with a bone through his nose, that man arose fully formed from mud at the behest of an invisible and all-powerful magic man with whom he communes on a daily basis. If there were an Olympics for projection, you'd not only win the gold, silver, and bronze, but you'd also be elected bullshit merchant-in-chief for life. So I'll finish up here by reiterating that your clumping together abiogenesis and evolution under the word origins doesn't suddenly make evolution dependent on naturalistic chemogenesis. It only demonstrates the magnitude of your dishonesty and your propensity to produce cranial flatulence of truly volcanic proportions. Neither does it magically transfer our uncertainty as to the accuracy of the current hypothesis for the origin of life to the theory that beautifully explains its diversification. It just demonstrates your complete inability to act like an honest and decent human being when defending the intellectually indefensible. So fuck you and your word games, Carl, because apart from your vast arsenal of lies and your willingness to use them at the drop of a hat without even a passing nod at your conscience, it seems that they are all you and your fellow creationists have got. This is going to be an unusual episode of Holy Hallucination, so before I begin, I'm going to take a few moments to explain how it came about. I was recently contacted by the user TheSoulEater37, who's writing a book on religion and atheism that'll include contributions from such great YouTubers as DPR Jones, Proportional Response, Brett P. Palmer, and Great Big Boar. SoulEater not only asked for permission to quote me, but also whether I'd mind answering in my own YouTube style some allegedly unanswerable questions posed by a theist. Since I normally prefer to just stick to defending science, I wasn't entirely sure whether to accept such an open invitation, but in the end I agreed and soon afterward was furnished with a list of banalities from none other than that greasy little car salesman of an apologist, Casey Luskin of the Discovery Institute of Misinformation and Downright Dishonesty. Now, some of these are questions that I'd not normally address because they're either outside my area of expertise, or not designed to discredit science, or are to do with the existence of God, who I'm not primarily here to try and disprove. However, because I didn't want to be accused of evasiveness, I decided to answer them all to the best of my ability. And since I'd taken the time to do that, I thought it would be silly not to kill two birds with one stone and use my answers as the basis of a Holy Hallucinations episode. So with all that said, let's cut to the chase and take a look at the pungent and crusty cerebral stools that our friend Casey thought would be so perplexing.
What is the origin of matter?
The currently accepted best explanation of the observable evidence, such as universal expansion, the relative abundance of hydrogen and helium, and the cosmic microwave background, is that our universe, and not only all matter and energy, but also space and time, arose from the expansion of a singularity approximately 13.8 billion years ago. As to what happened before that, well, while I'm not a physicist, it's my understanding that this is an area of active research and that numerous speculative hypotheses have been proposed. At the moment, however, the only honest answer is I don't know. And anyone who says they do know, particularly if they're claiming knowledge that posits that some kind of supernatural but suspiciously ephemeral entity is responsible, is nothing more than either a self-deluded or lying bag of stale piss. Because in reality, just like the rest of us, they don't know. They're just asserting they know or thinking wishfully because their childish, feeble minds aren't able to grow up and accept the reality that in the big, scary world, not everything's certain, and that there may not be someone out there to hold your hand when you need to go poopy. The inability of science to currently explain any given phenomenon in no way lends credence to the existence of any god, either past, present, or yet to be conjured up by the minds of men. If you want to make the claim that your God is responsible, then kindly provide both empirical and verifiable evidence of his existence and the mechanisms he employed in creating matter, or admit that you have no rational grounds for this claim and are just chalking it up to magic because it's easier than thinking about it. If you won't do either, then kindly just shut up and piss off.
What is the origin of information in DNA?
Science, of course, has developed a number of hypotheses with regard to the origin of the first self-replicating polymers and produced evidence to support many aspects of these ideas. So while no definitive answer has been arrived at in this nascent but rapidly growing field of study, it is disingenuous of you in the extreme to act as if this is a completely unaddressed and seemingly intractable problem in modern biology. If you had paid attention in college and spent less time learning to chase ambulances for a living, you might have realized this and not been doomed to making yourself look like an ignorant boob in public by asking stupid questions. Of course, the other possibility is that you're well aware of concepts such as the RNA world hypothesis, ribozymes, and hypercycles, but are deliberately ignoring them because you're a despicably dishonest fraud who doesn't care how big or how repugnant the lies he tells to push his agenda are, or about the consequences of pushing them. Making specific criticisms of scientific ideas and generating evidence to discredit them is one thing, but ignoring their existence entirely as evidence of only your abhorrent dishonesty. DNA doesn't contain any information in the sense that you and your fellow creationists like to refer to. It is a complex polymer built from four basic monomeric units that can be arranged in specific sequences to form unique structures. It is these structures that drive cellular chemical reactions in specific directions to produce other specific polymers with their own specific structures and specific functions. You're bastardizing the word information from the fact that these structures can and have been described by humans in a convenient four-letter shorthand. It is only once these sequences have been written down by humans and stored in computers that they become what you refer to as information, but they remain what they always were, nothing more than complex chemicals with equally complex chemical properties within the context of a cell. In hindsight, it's unfortunate that scientists adopted the code analogy in the development of the fields of molecular biology and genetics using words such as information, codon, transcript, and message. Though to be fair to them, how were they to know that this technical jargon was destined to be hijacked by a disingenuous cadre of filthy shysters who would later use it to imply that such information could only be produced by an intelligent mind? And not just any mind either, but the one described in particular primitive and childishly simplistic fables written long ago by a collection of ignorant goat molesters. So now that I've explained why you're yet again being dishonest with your language, and why you're ignoring large swathes of work that provide glimpses of the answers to this question, answers rooted in observable and quantifiable phenomena, perhaps you could do us the honor of providing your alternative, Casey. And remember that if what you come up with once you've stripped away all the fancy and illusory words you use to tart it up like a cheap harlot on a street corner in the end only amounts to God did it, then that's fine. Just be prepared to accept that your alternative is rooted in primitive superstition and not modern rationality. But if you can't bring yourself to do that because you don't want to look like an ignorant asshat who prefers to place his stock in fables and not facts, then please instead provide alternatives that are both credible and testable and also some empirical evidence to support them.
If you can't or won't, then I'd prefer it if you would just shut up and piss off.
How does consciousness work?
I'm starting to discern a pattern in these questions, so before I go on to give my answer, I want to build on something I said earlier. You see, all you seem to be doing so far is picking on a random physical phenomenon for which science has as yet not found a fully comprehensive explanation, and using it to imply that the only possible cause for the said phenomenon is your ephemeral, all-powerful, yet curiously anthropic pal. So if the purpose of your questions is to convince people that he actually exists and is merely suffering from a terminal case of shyness, then might I suggest that you'd be much better served by doing something to demonstrate that he has an actual basis in reality and isn't just the product of the collective hallucinations of primitive barbarians. Of course, I realize that it's a lot easier to sit back on your ass and pick holes in a work in progress rather than do some actual fucking work yourself, or for that matter do anything that might even remotely be interpreted as being intellectually honest, particularly since your fellow believers have been vainly trying to produce such evidence for 2 millennia. Instead, they've presented us with nothing but a string of wishful philosophical musings that have to struggle to convince anyone with even a vaguely open mind to keep their faith, let alone convince a freethinker to adopt it. While this laziness on your part somewhat pisses me off, it doesn't do so half as much as your refusal to own up to the consequence of your inability to explain exactly how your God produced these phenomena. Because in the end of the day, the answer's magic, isn't it, Casey? I strongly suspect that you and your fellow tribesmen know exactly how stupid it would look for adults to actually come out and admit that, so that's why you avoid the word like the plague. Instead, you rubbish the work of some of the greatest minds in history to propagate your spurious claims without having the balls to come out and show the world how ludicrously childish your alternative actually is. So with that said, let's get back to the matter in hand. While I know virtually nothing about the field of cognitive neuroscience, it appears that my knowledge in this area is still infinitely greater than yours, Casey. That is to say, I know at least a little more than fuck all about it. That's because I've read at least enough to know that while a comprehensive and detailed explanation of consciousness is not yet within our grasp, the phenomenon is no longer the complete mystery that you seem to be implying it is. In fact, it seems fairly clear that consciousness is an emergent property of a highly complex arrangement of an unimaginably vast array of interacting neurons. We know this because we can consistently image the same areas of the brain humming with activity following administration of the appropriate physical or psychological stimuli. We observe that damage to specific brain areas reproducibly results in the same cognitive dysfunctions. We are able to reliably reproduce specific emotions and behaviors upon physical stimulation of specific areas of the brain, and we know of countless chemical compounds that affect a stunning myriad of emotional and neuromotor functions and understand the molecular basis of their physical modes of action. Furthermore, it's been demonstrated that consciousness itself may not at all be what our subjective experiences think it is. It's been demonstrated conclusively that the subconscious brain can make decisions up to a full 10 seconds before the mind fools itself into thinking that it was responsible. This not only suggests that our inner workings are a lot more mechanical than we give them credit for, but also casts a serious shadow over the concept of free will, that old favorite that your kind used to rationalize why your God is justified in acting like a complete dipshit. Now, I realize that tards like you look upon the honest admission that there is more to learn about anything as profoundly unsatisfying and feel that your explanation, which in reality explains nothing, is somehow superior, especially if you assert it as fact with enough conviction. In this particular case, I assume that your explanation for the phenomenon of consciousness, at least in part, involves that yet again invisible and undetectable entity known as a soul. With that in mind, rather than just rubbishing the explanation that actually has some evidence to support it, why don't you stop asking stupid and disingenuous questions and instead take a stab at expounding on what a soul is, what it's made of, where we can find it, and exactly how it influences and interacts with the material world. Otherwise, please just shut up and piss off.
Why is there a universal morality?
This one's easy because there isn't one, and the only people I've ever heard claiming that a universal objective morality exists are those with a religious agenda.
This seems to be done while simultaneously ignoring mountains of evidently observable and historically documented evidence that morality is a fluid and continually evolving social construct created by people. What is considered moral in one culture can be regarded as downright abhorrent in another. For example, I'd warrant, Casey, that you'd consider that cutting off someone's hand for stealing is an immoral act, but there are many on this planet with convictions as strong as yours that might disagree. I personally think that what a man does with his own John Thomas, and who he does it with, is something best left to him and the four walls, whereas many who share your beliefs would judge him a monster should he choose to use it to play hide the sausage with the Pillsbury Doughboy. And even within your own cult, Casey, you have fine Christians who think it's perfectly acceptable to murder abortion providers while the majority of your fellow believers would condemn such actions as morally reprehensible. Historically, the Romans thought nothing of watching men slaughter each other or of feeding people to wild animals for entertainment. Nor was the rape of women by soldiers always considered off-limits, as depicted by your very own Bible and also in countless historical works of non-fiction. Even the mutilation and torture of people who had the gall not to share the beliefs of your fellow Christians was at one point not even considered to be a social faux pas. And to be honest, I suspect that there might be a few hidden amongst your ilk who secretly yearn for a return to the good old days. Of course, I suspect that you'll dismiss all these examples by claiming they just reflect the actions of imperfect men and not the will of your perfectly camouflaged moral lawgiver. I say this because I've lost count of the times I've heard the same old philosophical arguments for absolute morality from dishonest fuckers who seem to spend all their time peddling them as hard as they can, instead of actually trying to produce some evidence to support them. So rather than asserting that such transcendental morals do exist based on nothing but sophistic word games and wishful thinking, why don't you grow a pair of balls and support your claim by providing us with some credible and independently verifiable evidence for the existence of your lawgiver? Or just shut up and piss off.
If Darwinian evolution simply requires survival and reproduction, why do humans compose symphonies, write poetry, worship God, discover relativity, and sacrifice their lives for their enemies?
I can't imagine how long it took for this straw man to crawl out of the sludge that's slopping around between your ears and navigate its way through your digestive tract of freedom. But judging from the stench that accompanied it, I suspect that it was some time. I'm not sure if you should be more ashamed of yourself for producing such an unashamedly insincere question or such an extraordinarily retarded one. The evolution of adaptive intelligence was one of the primary drivers for our success as a species. Our development as social animals, however, may arguably have been equally important, for we are undoubtedly more successful in groups than we would be as individuals. Selection for altruism, which is not incidentally unique to humans, and for positive group behaviors which manifest themselves as what we now call morality would undoubtedly have given our ancestors a competitive reproductive advantage. Intelligence, on the other hand, led us to formulate solutions to increasingly complex problems. In more primitive times, however, many natural phenomena seemed inexplicable, and so this intelligence was applied to concocting fantastic explanations in terms of what could be understood at the time. That is, by resorting to the vagaries of suspiciously anthropic gods. It may have escaped your notice, Casey, but the path of history is strewn with the desiccated corpses of countless gods and goddesses whose existence was as blindly unquestioned by their followers as the existence of yours is by you. Eventually, though, that intelligence was put to more productive use following the development and formalization of the process known as the scientific method, which only further facilitated our success as a species. This also allowed humanity to eschew spurious supernatural superstitious rationalizations in favor of explanatory and predictive utilitarian models of reality based on empirical and objective evidence, models that include Einstein's general theory of relativity. All of this can be explained in terms of Darwinian evolution, but only to those who wish to listen and understand rather than stick their heads up their asses to prevent the intrusion of anything resembling reality into their cherished fables. Just like science, music, art, and literature are all side effects of the intelligence that first arose as a survival strategy on the African savanna. So if your aim is to imply that these human activities could not conceivably have arisen during biological evolution, then kindly explain specifically which parts of evolutionary theory preclude this possibility and a detailed mechanistic explanation of why. Otherwise, just shut up and piss off.
Why do so many people believe in God if evolution wired us to be logical and there is no God?
Oh, for fuck's sake, Casey. Are you serious, or are you deliberately trying to create the impression that your brain's taken a permanent vacation and left your rectum to do your thinking and talking for you? It's quite clear, even from the most fleeting glances at the world around us, or failing that, just the questions you've been asking, that the human race is far from wired to be logical. It's only been 400 years since we've started to systematically explain the world around us compared to the millennia of religious mumbo-jumbo that prior to that passed for knowledge. That kind of historical indoctrination takes a long time to overcome, but fortunately it does seem that growing scientific literacy is slowly eroding the prevalence of superstitious thinking that you and your kind seem to be so bent on perpetuating. Of course, all of this would be happening a lot faster if you and your fellow lying fuckers at the Discovery Institute would just shut up and piss off.
Why are atheists so obsessed with God?
I, for one, give not one shit for your God or anyone else's, since all the divine beings I've ever heard of seem to be quite obviously the figments of human imaginations. I'm as obsessed with gods as I am with other irrelevant fictions such as fairies, unicorns, and witches. That is to say, not in the fucking least. And the simple reason is that since they're non-existent, none of these things can affect my life in any way whatsoever, and so they seldom have occasion to make me spend any time even thinking about them. The same applies to your and all other gods, because they're as relevant to my life as an inflatable doll is to a eunuch's. So when it comes to the moderate theist, the kind that understands that others may not share their beliefs and have the right not to have them imposed upon them or shoved down their throats, I have little problem. If these were the only kinds of theists in the world, I've little doubt that the concept of God would seldom, if ever, cross my mind. However, when fundamentalist nutjobs start trying to tell me how to live my life based on what they believe, then the issue of God becomes relevant to me. In particular, I've become obsessed with standing up to the stupidity and dishonesty of creationists like yourself. Stupidity and dishonesty that you've done a fabulous job of demonstrating with your questions so far. I've lost all tolerance for ignorant buffoons who strut out into public and expect the insane drivel that they're spewing to be blindly accepted instead of challenged. When people like you start to spread your putrid lies, I'm going to do my very best to point out the stench and exactly where it's coming from. So if you want to know why the majority of atheists appear to be so obsessed by God, Casey, it's really quite simple. It's because smug, dishonest, and wantonly ignorant little pricks like you simply refuse to shut up and piss off.
Why are atheists so unilaterally uncivil?
It should be abundantly clear from either the quite astonishing levels of disingenuousness in the questions you've been asking here, or from the unfortunate mental dysfunction that causes you to pose them, exactly why some atheists are uncivil. In addition, your very assertion that this behavior is unilateral is a perfect example of the kind of outrageously mendacious behavior that is positively guaranteed to have people lining up to call you a slimy little shitstreak of an excuse for a human being. Because while I won't deny that I have no qualms of and make no apologies for telling dishonest twats exactly what I think of them, there are of course plenty of atheists out there who have a lot more patience, respect, and manners than I. Conversely, I've seen the most hateful and reprehensible behavior from hordes of theists all over the internet and on my YouTube channel, behavior that makes me look angelic by comparison and that makes the theists that engage in it look like the most wicked and vile monsters imaginable. So for you to claim that rudeness is the sole domain of the atheist is a true testament to either the magnitude of the brain defect that's responsible for your delusions, or a measure of the vastness of your disregard for both truth and decency. And on that note, now that I've answered your questions, I think it'd be best all round if you'd just shut up and fuck off. This is a response to P.P. Simmons' video, Evo Takes Another Hard Fall, Slammed Again, Tiktaalik Not a Transitionary Fossil. Well, Carl, just when I thought you'd given up on smearing science with the vile filth that's continually being disgorged by that pasty organ that passes for your brain,
You've surprised me by puking up two fine new examples of creationist mental manure in short succession. I dealt with your somewhat unconventional ideas regarding the nature of science in Holy Hallucinations 26, but it appears that I was a little too gentle with you on that occasion because you seem to have been able to sit down a lot earlier than I expected to produce this new video, in which you offer us your profound insights into the paleontological significance of Tiktaalik. As luck would have it, Carl, I recently finished reading Your Inner Fish by Neil Shubin, the co-discoverer of this particular fossil. This quite stunning coincidence almost had me thinking that it had been deliberately orchestrated by some kind of omniscient and omnipotent yet empirically elusive celestial agency. So if that does happen to be the case, Carl, I can only assume that you've been a naughty, naughty boy, and that the said agency brought about this state of affairs to afford me the opportunity to ram Professor Shubin's book roughly up your arse, sideways. So let's get on to the matter in hand and take a look at what you had to say, and while we watch the first clip, Carl, might I suggest you drop your strides, bend over, and get ready to take your divine punishment like a man.
According to an intriguing article from Creation Ministries International, tracts of footprints found in a quarry in Poland have turned the evolutionary world upside down. For years, there has been a neat evolutionary story, CMI says, about how fish evolved four legs and came out of the ocean onto the land.
The first thing I did after I saw your video, Carl, was something that appears to be anathema to you, and that's a little research. It appears that you've based your latest 3-minute and 49-second offering of digital diarrhea solely on a single article by a gentleman named Walker. While superficially it seems that Dr. Wanker's PhD in mechanical engineering doesn't really qualify him as an authority in the areas of paleontology and evolutionary biology, it turns out that he does hold a bachelor's in earth science. This means that Dr. Wanker can't claim ignorance as an excuse, and so, having suffered through reading his article, I can only conclude that he's either the dumbest fuck to ever earn a degree, or the biggest liar to emerge from the creationist camp since Kent Hovind pulled out his biro and started filling in his first tax return. In either case, of course, this didn't stop you from wolfing down this festering intellectual turd as if it were the last donut at a cops convention, and then spewing it back up all over YouTube in your own inimitable style. And as for the neat evolutionary story with regard to the origins of tetrapods, I presume that this is the same story that is part of perhaps the most empirically supported theoretical edifice in all of science and the cornerstone of modern biology. You know, the same theory that you and your fellow lying fuckers disparage at every opportunity because it not only demonstrates that your cherished fables are based in imagination and not fact, but also because it interferes with your ability to cling to the notion that humans are somehow better than animals, despite your own behavior doing nothing other than demonstrate that your own place in nature is somewhere between a tapeworm and a pubic louse. So we'll get back to those Polish footprints later, but for now let's get on and see why you and Dr. Wanker have a problem with physical evidence in general and Tiktaalik specifically.
Probably the most famous fossil in this sea-to-land icon of evolution is Tiktaalik rosae, a fish with fins that was claimed to have had features intermediate between fish and tetrapods. Creationists consistently rejected the evolutionary spin put on the fossil and showed that it had nothing to do with the alleged sea-to-land transition.
Tiktaalik has been extensively studied by the world's most highly trained and respected paleontologists and anatomists, who have dedicated lifetimes to become leading experts in these fields. These experts have published their results in the world's most prestigious scientific journal, and their work has therefore been thoroughly vetted by passing the critical review of their peers. From this, we know that Tiktaalik was an animal that was in the process of transitioning from an aquatic to a terrestrial lifestyle because it possessed some of the characteristics of fish, some of tetrapods, and some intermediate between the two. On the fish side, it had webbed fins, scales, and gills, while numerous skeletal features such as the combination of a humerus, tibia, and fibula with radiating fish-like digits in the forelimbs, the size and placement of the spiracles or ear notches, and the dimensions of the higher mandibula in the skull are clearly intermediate between their counterparts in fish and early tetrapods. On the tetrapod side, Tiktaalik had eyes placed atop a flat head, lungs, ribs, an articulating neck, and a pectoral girdle that wasn't attached to its head. Features that are never found in fish but are common to most tetrapods. It's interesting then, Carl, that while pointing out that creationists rejected the evolutionary spin put on the fossil, you also claim that this miserable collection of incompetent and dishonest buffoons showed that it had nothing to do with the sea-land transition. As far as I'm aware, creationists have done no such thing. As an example, let's take Jonathan Safarty's article for Creation Ministries International on the subject of Tiktaalik. It seems he has a PhD in physical chemistry, which apparently eminently qualifies him to reject the essentially unanimous opinion of the world's paleontological community, but unfortunately all his article essentially amounts to is a series of outrageously dishonest quote mines and quite stupendously inaccurate representations of the mechanics of evolution and the nature of transitional forms. In this particular digital shitstream, Dr. Farty does nothing to discredit Tiktaalik's mixture of fish and tetrapod characters, and instead tries to muddy the waters by working on the simplistic and probably intentionally misleading assumption that the fossil record represents a lineage of direct descent rather than a phylogeny of both closely and distantly related cousins, and by discounting the well-established concept of evolutionary stasis. To illustrate a point, let's take a look at how Shubin, Deschler and Jenkins describe the articulation of Tiktaalik's humerus in their landmark Nature paper. The simultaneous apposition of the reversed concavo-convex geometries of the anterior and posterior parts of the articulation represents a close-packed, almost stable joint position. Additionally, stability would be contributed through the action of the transcoracoid musculature. Now, let's compare this with what Dr. Farty had to say about that particular part of the anatomy.
Indeed, Tiktaalik's fin was not connected to the main skeleton, so could not have supported its weight on land. The discoverers claimed that this could have helped to prop up the body as the fish moved along a water bottom, but evolutionists had similar high hopes for the coelacanth fin.
Notice the complete lack of technically descriptive detail, the failure to even attempt to provide an argument to support the bold assertion, and the substitution of said argument with a pathetically transparent guilt-by-association logical fallacy. Anyone with any kind of background in science will immediately recognize Farty's language as that of either a rank amateur or sophist that could only be convincing to someone who's either been extensively indoctrinated or is recovering from a particularly nasty cerebral embolism. You know, Carl, someone like you. So while this might count as showing to you, to anyone with an ability to sustain an even vaguely coherent thought process, in reality it's merely reminiscent of a retard standing up and either proclaiming, "No, it's not," to every statement of fact or settling for shouting nothing but, "It's a fish," in lieu of argumentation, while fully expecting to be taken seriously. Rejecting something outright without specifying precisely why, Carl, doesn't constitute an argument because it's so easy that any subnormal fuckwit can do it. For example, if I wanted to, I could quite happily make myself look like a complete tit by claiming that Barack Obama is not a US citizen, whilst providing not one shred of evidence or even a cogent argument to support it. Of course, that wouldn't mean I was right, just that I was a complete and utter twat and quite possibly the dumbest fuck on the planet.
Richard Dawkins, in his latest book, The Greatest Show on Earth, claims Tiktaalik is the perfect missing link. Perfect because it almost exactly splits the difference between fish and amphibian, and perfect because it is missing no longer, Dawkins says. But now this footprint evidence from Poland consigns Tiktaalik and all its companion fossils onto the garbage heap.
Unfortunately, despite your most fervent desires, Carl, as we'll see later, the footprint evidence does nothing of the kind. I'm afraid that your ambitious claims about the fate of Tiktaalik and other alpistostegid fossils is about as accurate as the Vatican's pronouncements on viral epidemiology. It is unfortunate that Dawkins used the outdated layman's term missing link because it leaves the impression that paleontologists claim that transitional fossils are de facto direct ancestors of either other fossilized life forms or of extant species. It's exactly this fallacious misconception that pompous asshats like Jonathan Farty and the collection of other CMI numbnuts he cites in his so-called article use as the basis for their ludicrously simple-minded arguments. In reality, paleontologists take pains to point out that such fossils are much more likely to have been cousins, side shoots, and the Tree of Life, but nevertheless most likely reasonable representations of the actual common ancestors of the major evolutionary lineages. That's because the only way to be 100% certain of any given phylogeny is to watch and track every single birth along the lineage, and while this might be the only kind of evidence that the most delusional of creationists would accept, and even then, quite frankly, I'm not convinced they would, anyone even vaguely in tune with the concept of reality will realize that that's not going to happen. So despite what you say, Carl, Tiktaalik remains a transitional fossil because it was never purported to be the basal ancestor of the tetrapod lineage, but because it bears a distinct mosaic of characters of both fish and tetrapods as well as several intermediate features, and as a result represents a reasonable approximation of that ancestor. This very fact is wonderfully illustrated by the following passage from Neil Shubin's book Your Inner Fish, where he describes what happened when he took a cast of Tiktaalik to his son's kindergarten class and asked them what they thought it was. Hands shot up. The first kid said it was a crocodile or an alligator. When queried why, he said that like a crocodile or lizard, it had a flat head with eyes on top. Big teeth, too. Other children started to voice their dissent. Choosing the raised hand from one of the kids, I heard, "No, no, it isn't a crocodile, it is a fish, because it has scales and fins." Yet another child shouted, "Maybe it is both." Tiktaalik's message is so straightforward, even preschoolers can see it. And that's exactly the point, Carl. The significance of Tiktaalik is blindingly obvious to even a five-year-old, and yet escapes the attention of grown men and women suffering from that tragic case of profound mental retardation known as creationism. I fervently hope that one day both you and the poor people whose minds you're poisoning with your delusions will just grow up.
Creation International claims that it has now been demonstrated in a strong case that these supposed evolutionary links were in reality four-legged animals that resembled large lizards.
I was in two minds as to whether to include this clip because the point I wanted to make might seem a little trivial. In the end, I decided to use it though, Carl, because it's a wonderful demonstration of exactly how big a bunch of dim-witted bell-ends Tazwanker you and your snivelling toadies at the P.P. Simmons channel truly are. And that's because the original Nature paper, which you quite evidently didn't bother to read before you opened up the spigot of this particular sewer, doesn't mention reptiles at all and in fact uses a generic representation of the early amphibian tetrapods Ichthyostega and Acanthostega. In case you didn't know what the rest of us learnt in third grade, Carl, lizards are reptiles, not amphibians, which may not matter much to you, but I can assure you matters considerably to the animals concerned, which is why it is exceedingly rare to come across a frog trying to fuck an alligator. As I said, this is somewhat of a minor point, but I decided to bring it up to illustrate not only your but also Taz Walker's complete disregard for anything even vaguely approaching academic rigor and your complete disdain for those pesky inconveniences that the rest of us refer to as facts.
If four-legged animals existed 18 million years earlier, then Tiktaalik can't be the transitional fossil it has been claimed to be. Tiktaalik has suddenly been demoted to an evolutionary dead end, along with all the other fossils connected with it. In other words, all those neat evolutionary diagrams that vividly displayed the transition from fish to four-footed animal ancestor now need to be disposed of.
So now we're getting down to the heart of the matter, so let's get this over with. Firstly, despite your deluded and uninformed assertions, Tiktaalik is very much still a transitional fossil for the reasons I gave earlier. However, if, as I strongly suspect, what you are trying to say is that Tiktaalik cannot be the direct common ancestor of extant tetrapods, then surprisingly, you'd be right. But since no credible paleontologist or evolutionary biologist has ever claimed it was, then your point is somewhat moot, isn't it? At the risk of repeating myself, these species have never been purported to be our direct ancestors, but rather representative cousins of those ancestors. Using the diagram you yourself showed, anyone who cares to can clearly see that all of these species are not placed in a line of direct descent, but rather as offshoots of it. You see, Carl, your doltish ignorance of evolutionary theory and the inability of your woefully crippled mind to understand or read a cladogram doesn't magically lend credence to your assertions,
It simply provides the rest of us with yet more opportunities to laugh at you. The reason this matters is because due to the documented phenomenon of evolutionary stasis, these alpistostegids were more than capable of living contemporaneously with tetrapods because both could have evolved earlier from common alpistostegid stock. Tiktaalik therefore represents a lineage that remained morphologically relatively stable while the tetrapod lineage continued to evolve to exploit the free ecological niches being offered by land. This is exactly why there are still coelacanths and lungfish alive today alongside all the tetrapods that descended from their common sarcopterygian ancestor. It's because we didn't evolve from coelacanths, Carl. We evolved from a coelacanth-like species that lived and died over 400 million years ago. As a result, the effect of this discovery on the previous phylogeny isn't quite as dramatic as you and your mate Taz would like to make it out to be, and was in fact quite succinctly summarized by Niedźwiedzki and colleagues in the final figure of their paper. In fact, I found it fascinating that Dr. Wanker didn't include this figure in his article. I wonder, Carl, do you think it was because he was so ignorant on the subject on which he judged himself qualified to pontificate that he didn't realize its significance? Or was it because he knew full well that if he showed it, it might tip off the people he was so enthusiastically lying to exactly how full of shit he is? Whether Taz was being deliberately deceitful or merely retarded is neither here nor there, though, because in either case the net effect was that he didn't present the diagram that would have shown exactly how much hot air had gone into overinflating the effect of this discovery on evolutionary theory. You see, Carl, while it certainly does lead to a reassessment of the timing and environment of the water-to-land transition, all that has happened is that the original phylogeny has been stretched back 18 million years to accommodate the new find, creating a slew of so-called ghost lineages where both tetrapods and alpistostegids must have coexisted but have not yet been discovered in the fossil record. Imperfections in this record are nothing new and have long been recognized and well documented. For example, Roma's gap originally ran from 360 to 345 million years ago, a critical period in early tetrapod evolution, and while recent discoveries have closed it somewhat, it still remains a poor source of information for this period of life's history. There's a gap of some 60 million years in the record of pachycephalosaurs, which are present both before and after it, while the coelacanth, which is still with us, hasn't been found in the fossil record since the Cretaceous, representing a ghost range of some 80 million years. And while 18 million years may seem like a long time, try considering it in comparison to the 3.8 billion years since life first arose or the 660 million years since the appearance of multicellularity. The big deal you're trying to make here, Carl, amounts to an adjustment of one half to less than 3%. So while the discovery is scientifically a highly significant contribution to our understanding of tetrapod evolution, it's hardly the silver bullet that you and your fellow fuckwits have been dreaming of finding to take out the werewolf that's been pounding your beliefs up the arse for the past 150 years.
Something of the magnitude of the upset can be gleaned from statements made about the find in Nature magazine. Quote, "This forces a radical reassessment of the timing, ecology, and environmental setting of the fish tetrapod transition, as well as the completeness of the body fossil record." And this quote, "It will cause a significant reappraisal of our understanding of tetrapod origins."
You may not have noticed this, Carl, but neither of these statements or the other tactical quote mines in Taz Wanker's article say anything to the effect of, "This discovery seriously undermines the entire basis of evolutionary theory and thus forces us to consider alternative hypotheses with regards to the generation of biological diversity, particularly those concocted millennia ago by ignorant, bloodthirsty desert goat fuckers." All of these quotes exemplify the nature of science and the scientific method, which is obliged to consider all new data and modify its explanations to reflect the collected evidence as accurately as possible. Of course this new evidence will result in the reformulation of current phylogenies, a reassessment of the timing of the colonization of land, and because the tracks were discovered in what used to be a marine environment, a revision of the hypothesis that the transition might have occurred in rivers. Now let's contrast this self-correcting and intellectually honest approach to discovering the truth with your particular religious mindset, shall we, Carl? You know, the mindset that'll never allow you to admit you're wrong no matter how much evidence is rammed unceremoniously up your tailpipe,
nor how hard you have to fly in the face of patently demonstrable reality. The mindset that means that even if Lord Vishnu himself were to materialize before both you and your pal Taz, cut off your dangly bits and shove them up each other's body cavities, you'd still insist that yours was the only true religion and that Hindus were the ones who were being delusional. How well do you think that mindset would have served us in this ever-changing world if everyone had chosen to adopt it, Carl? Could it be that we'd still be sitting around our darkened hovels, dining on roast witch, debating how many feathers are on an angel's wing, and discussing who was going to be the next guest on the Torture the Heretic show? All in all, I'm glad that ignorant fuckers like you didn't get your way, and grateful to those in the past who chose discovery and enlightenment over dogma and superstition. You see, Carl, the kinds of statements you and Taz quoted are indicative of the strength of science, and not some kind of fatal weakness that you seem to think you're dramatically exposing. Of course, you at least have some excuse for peddling this particular line of nonsensical bullshit, because you are, after all, an ignorant asshat who doesn't know the difference between his pyloric and his highly dilated anal sphincter. Dr. Wanker, on the other hand, has at least allegedly a scientific background, and so for him to use these perfectly legitimate statements to sleazily smear genuine science with his putrid misrepresentations proves just one thing, and that's exactly how big a lying shitbag he is. But then again, he is a creationist, so unlike the Polish trackways, that shouldn't come as much of a surprise.
Those scientists who have dedicated their lives and careers to the standard fish-to-beast story will not be very enthused by the implications of the latest find. They will be reluctant to change, especially since they have nothing to replace it with, CMI says.
Jesus fucking H. Christ, Carl. The thing that amazes me about your videos is that just when one thinks you've plunged to the very limits of human mental retardation, you somehow manage to find a way to push the envelope just a little further. In this case, you and Taz have managed to reach the intellectual level of an amoeba, and not a particularly bright one at that. In response to this particular festering turd, I'd simply ask one question. Who the fuck exactly do you think discovered these tracks and published them in one of the world's most respected journals? I think you'll find it was none other than those scientists who've dedicated their lives and careers to the standard fish-to-beast story. Does this really seem like the action of people who'd be so crushed by the implications of this new evidence? If they were really that concerned, Carl, wouldn't it have made more sense to suppress it? After all, that's an accusation that many of your fellow fucktards make on a regular basis, and which you and Taz have done a fine job of demonstrating is simply yet another pile of steaming creationist crap. I myself can't imagine the magnitude of the neural dysfunction that would allow any human being to make this kind of patently ludicrous pronouncement and do it in all seriousness. This assertion, or more to the point, the fact that neither you or Taz seem to realize how utterly and unambiguously self-poning it is, really does highlight the toxic nature of your particular flavor of belief, Carl, because its poison cripples minds to the point where reality and fantasy, sanity and psychosis, and truth and delusion become indistinguishable. For your information, you sad and pathetic little man, surprises such as these are the lifeblood of working scientists. They provide new challenges, new opportunities for discovery, and new questions to be asked and answered. In this particular case, a new span of 18 million years and a new environmental milieu to explore, I'm sure has paleontologists everywhere chomping at the bit to get into the field and uncover what I'm sure are going to be some particularly spectacular new fossil finds. That's because, unlike you, Carl, these people aren't happy to settle for the warmth of the comfort blanket provided by the certainty of dogmatic beliefs whose accuracy isn't important, but instead are driven with the desire to explore the vistas of the unknown, to uncover the truth about nature, and by the thrill of discovery. And I personally thank my lucky stars for people like them, Carl, because if in the past it had been entirely up to people like you, we wouldn't be discovering the magnificence of this breathtaking universe and the intricacy of the wonders of life. Instead, we'd be eking out a miserable existence and explaining everything with primitive fables and magic.